Welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Yes, indeed, indeed. 866-901-ADAM. 866-901-ADAM. Neil Patrick Harris is going to be in. Ted Casablanca from E is going to come in and dish a little dirt. Big Tad's going to get dressed up as a Girl Scout and hit the streets. Rachel, how say you?
I say yay.
I say yay, too.
I feel sorry for Tad. He was sick this weekend, he told me, but my only regret is that I'm not going to be out there watching.
Something went down this weekend, because I was sick this weekend, and I hear Dave Damaschek
laid up
was sick as well.
You guys have a kissing party or something?
We did 7 minutes in heaven, which is we go into the closet. Dave and I masturbate while Tad eats. Sorry, it's a little twist. Involves eating. What did you have? I had a stomach flu.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What does that mean? Vomiting?
Diarrhea.
Oh, no.
The entire weekend.
Well, that didn't go well
Beautiful.
For me either.
Really?
But it was just laid up, you know, with the cold sweats and the sneezing fits and so on
sneezing.
And so forth.
Well, I'm trying to think. Like I'm, you know, there's a couple things to say. First off, you know, there's colds and then there's colds. I will take a head cold over the nausea any day of the week.
Sure.
I didn't have nausea. I was just on the toilet.
Tap ass.
The entire, like, all of Friday night. But the only thing that's worse than when you're sick is when other people are sick and they head into work anyway, and then they make the proclamation that they came in. This happened to me at Kimmel. This happened at Kimmel a couple of years back where I got the flu. I don't get sick very often. That's the other thing, too. You know, you should get good. First off, society and your boss and the workplace and everything, they should know the difference between the people that are out every other week because they're allergic to something and those of us who never miss a day. I never miss a day because of illness, but at Kimmel, a couple of years back, I got the flu. And I got that crazy thing I get about once every 5 years where I'm vomiting so hard I feel like my innards are going to come out of my mouth. And, you know, there's just that sort of just take me, Lord, kind of, you know, that kind of nausea flu thing where you I was groaning alone. Like normally you might groan to summon a little, you know, a little pity from those of you. My wife went out of town. What a woman, by the way. She went to Las Vegas. And I was lying in bed just groaning, not this weekend, but this is a few years. I was crawled down the stairs and stuff. I don't know what, you know, I was leveled. I'm sturdy stock. I'm super sturdy stock. I had hernia surgery on a Friday night and Saturday morning. I was swinging closet doors at my house. I'm not a complainer. High threshold. I was destroyed by this. Missed the day of Kimmel.
Was it E. coli?
You
probably had E. coli.
I had something heinous. And if it would have lasted, you know, if you would have said to me, and again, I'm talking a couple years back, looking good, Big Ted. If you would have said, look, would you like to die if this is going to go on more than how many days? The over-under would have been 2.5 days. In 3 days, I would have said, just take me now. But the real shot in the ribs came when I went to Kimmel the following day or 2 days later and said, yeah, man, I was wiped out and everyone did that. Yeah, I had the flu too, but I came in. You know that guy?
Yeah.
And of course, you know, just picture the look on Kimmel's face from across the writer's table. Yeah, we all had something, but show had to go on. And I was like, no, you didn't have what I had. Oh, yeah. Oh, I had it, man. People are telling their stories of woe. They woke up at 4 a.m. They're vomiting. But, you know, 8:45 came around. They pulled their trousers up and came into work. And I said, you don't understand. I couldn't physically propel myself. I couldn't walk. I couldn't stand up. There's just sweat pouring down my head. Well, look, we came in. That guy, you shouldn't be allowed. You should not be allowed to say, if somebody misses a day because they're vomiting, you should not be allowed to say, yeah, I had what you had too, but I just, you know, we're cut out of a different cloth.
If you come into work, you shouldn't be allowed to complain about being sick.
Then you're not sick.
Yeah.
That's it. We'll assume that you're, it's like you're nicked up, but you're not injured. You can play. If you can play, you can play.
You
I don't
need
hear
to impose what you had on them or get a refresher every couple of years to see what that feels like. Because when you talk about the crawling thing,
right.
No one could possibly work through that. Remember in New Orleans at the Super Bowl about
yes.
3-4 years ago?
Yes.
I ate an oyster.
Yes.
And about 24 hours later, I took a sick that I hope to never experience again. And as Ace just said, I take me rather than go through that again. I counted in 7 hours in New Orleans. This is me in a hotel room with yeah. Cousin Sal, the worst guy to have any weakness in
he's
front
no
of.
He's no Florence Nightingale.
He's trying to break the door down. I'm crawling to the toilet. And after about like you do it 3 times. By the way, 7 hours, yes. 20 pukes.
I was there.
20 pukes. This is true. But after like the third one, you have nothing left. And what caught my ear is the sounds you make when yeah. you're alone. Everybody else left me, thankfully, at some point in the room. But the sounds you're making into that toilet bowl, the yelps and pathetic squeals, like, ah! Trying to get something out of yourself into the toilet bowl.
Yes.
It's the most pathetic. The only thing that saves you is the dementia.
Yeah.
If you didn't lose your mind when you're doing it, you would shoot yourself.
And your body just angry and convulsing. Like there's some demon it's trying to exercise or something. Yeah, when it's just and I don't know if there is a worse, 24, 48 hours. I don't know that you can feel worse than that. I mean, I really do think anything else you get is sort of localized. I mean, you could step on a landmine and have your leg amputated. At least the pain is limited to the extremities or to the stump or whatever. There's no more all over encompassing pain than that sort of just crazy nausea, except for the part where if you did pull it together and drag yourself dehydrated into work the following day and everyone looked in and said, yeah, we're sick too, Sheck, but we decided to come in because we feel the show's important.
Yeah. Well, the problem is that you have at the head of that show, you have Kimmel himself, who will drag himself, who actually overdosed on Advil once and over the course of the show devolved into a barely functioning human being and yet still plowed through the show. So everybody follows his example.
OD'd on Advil.
He did.
He's the only
his head exploded.
I didn't see it.
He was out of his mind.
He's the only celebrity, though, in Hollywood that OD'd on Advil.
Yeah.
That's true. Talk about a straight arrow. Jesus Christ. Couldn't even OD on a real drug. He ate too many Advil. His head turned red, and it blew up. And then his eyes swole shut. Well, he's very...
I remember hearing about that.
Kimmel is kind of, he'll be on later on this week. Kimmel, he's kind of like a purebred lap dog in that he has allergies and he's not the mixed lab retriever one that can sleep, get run over by a pickup truck and still be fine, not even walk with a limp. He's got a lot of allergies and a lot of environmental stuff and he gets gassy very easily. It's funny. He's a combination between a sort of bulldozer and a 50s British sports car. Like lots of maintenance and lots of work. On the other hand, sort of super hardy and very manly at the same time.
Yeah, because he still makes it through. Is the point? Yeah. But given all his ailments,
he's a gamer.
Right.
I was watching CNN this morning. It was all Mardi Gras. Fat Tuesdays tomorrow and all that. I was watching all the news and it reminded me of a couple things. One is when Kimmel and I were out in New Orleans and we got to ride the float and be the what do they call the guy who gets to be the float, the master of ceremony,
Grand Marshal.
Grand Marshal. Thank you. The Grand Marshal of a parade in New Orleans. Except for we were filling in for Tommy Lasorda, the ex-Dodgers manager. He was supposed to be the Grand Marshal and dropped out at the last moment. So Kimmel and I stepped in to take over for Tommy Lasorda and our New Orleans. And now, a couple things. First off, they take parades over there very seriously. Like, I don't mind a parade, but I don't have parade equipment at home. Stuff I actually get out. They have things. They have modified ladders that they throw their kids up. They throw their kids up on these A-frame ladders. The ladders have been modified to have like a bench at the top. And then the kid's wearing like a hoop around his neck that says, throw your beads here. And everyone goes nuts with the beads. The beads we had a huge medallion of Tommy Lasorda. And if anyone would ever... Just picture in your mind what a 50-cent piece would look like with Tommy Lasorda's head on, except for very cheaply made, you know, penny a piece kind of thing. First off, Tommy Lasorda looks gross and bizarre in this, and you don't know who it is. It just looks like a fat old man, and then you read, it says Tommy Lasorda underneath it. But the fact that me and Kimmel threw out 13,000 Tommy Lasorda beads just added to the confusion. So people would be standing along the parade route because they didn't have enough time to get the Jimmy and Adam beads going, just the big Tommy Lasorda medallion beads. And everyone would be standing parade side. Hey, man, show! Hey, man! And you just throw these beads, and they go sailing, and then some guy in the back of a pickup truck would grab it. Yeah, man, show! And then you'd show him look at the beads, and he'd do that, well, it's kind of a triple take. He'd do that, like, down to the bead. Tommy, and then back up to the float. Like, where's Tommy Lasorda? And then back to the beat. Who's Tommy Lasorda? Like, he didn't coach our team. And then back to the float again. And by then, we were gone. And we left a trail of question marks behind
this is
us.
The weirdest man show prank ever.
Yes, it was
it's
funny.
Actually genius.
You could never explain that the thing moved just fast enough that you could never yell why. And I have obviously no one had a heads up that Tommy Lasorda was supposed to be the grand marshal. It's just a whole bunch of looks of eyebrows turned up. Like, what the? And that was it. But there's nothing better. First off, if you like throwing stuff, this is your job, Grand Marshal. Because there's nothing better than throwing stuff from a moving vehicle. As a kid, being in the back of some pickup truck or something, throwing an apple at one of your buddies or something as he swung by the house when he was on the front lawn. Or just the idea of throwing while moving is very exciting. Even when the quarterback rolls out of the pocket, it's exciting. You just, on a huge boat. And the thing that's funny, too, is we were dressed as pirates, which is we don't have an outfit for you outfit. Like, well, you got to be Grand Marshal of the parade. All right. Well, let's see. We got the man show. What's the theme of this year? Just put the pirate outfit on. Well, why? Well, it's a parade. Are pirates famous for parades, by the way? Like, how did this become just a go-to costume for all? Yeah, no, put the thing. Here's the sword. Put the patch over your eye. It's pirates. A good time, you know.
Pirates have gotten a bad rap in society. You know, pirate was cool until about, you know, 80, 100 years ago. Then think of all the damage it's gotten. Now it's got the gay association, you know. It's got the corporate pirates. Now it's like it connotes of guys, old guys in suits. The Pittsburgh Pirates, sadly, are lousy.
What about fake gold? Pyrite?
Yes. Again, yes.
Sort of.
movie pirates, too. Like, yeah.
That's
the
right.
Pirating
videotapes, yeah.
Oh, yeah, right.
That's right.
It used to be the baddest of the bad if you were a pirate. Now you may be gay. Oh. You're the worst baseball team in the league.
And you're a computer nerd.
You'd know I was gay if you saw me in this outfit. Gold lame, sash,
by the
sword.
Way, never more appropriately named than this year, Float in New Orleans.
Sad, but true. So we zigzagged our way throughout, and we didn't go down the main drag. We they have so many parades in New Orleans around Mardi Gras that they'll just go through people's houses and down cul-de-sacs and stuff. It's not like it's all down the main drag. It's not like, well, you go down to the end of Bourbon Street, you turn around, you come back. No, no. Go to Bourbon Street, turn right. Before you know it, you're just deep in the bowels of Louisiana. You're just driving down people's streets. You're literally going down people's side streets. You're just turning, and you're going down, and people are just sitting out on their lawns.
It's a parade for the people.
Oh, yeah. Well, technically people. If you had to sort of classify them, they need some sort of phylum. You would put them with other people. But I mean, oh man, you should have seen these people. I mean, you think, you know, when you get off, we get a little snobby over here being out from Los Angeles and everything. Like when you get off of the main drag in like Louisiana, when you get into the deep part, when you get into a just sort of John Q. Public out there in the bio, look out. It's scary. Frightening. Frightening kind of Hills Have Eyes kind of frightening meets Deliverance kind of frightening. I'm sure much happier than all of us collectively, but frightening. So drinking beers and chucking beads, though, nothing better. Nothing better than when you see some guy way out in the distance and he's sitting in the back of the pickup truck and he had his girlfriend and he's sitting on the cooler and I'm holding the beer. I was loaded in the hot sun by block number two and the parade was like 35 miles. You just keep cracking beers and just seeing some guy and just spotting him and just up in the crow's nest and just, oh, threw my arm out with those Tommy Lasorda beads.
Must have been a dream come true for you, all the boobies.
Didn't, you know what? The daytime parade boobies were not running free like they do on the New Orleans, on Bourbon Street at
boobies.
Night.
Disappointing. Yeah.
Little disappointing, but I'll tell you, most it's not like the movies, you know? It's not like Roadhouse where everyone in there is a hot extra. You know, go down. You didn't want to see, first off, more man booby than woman booby by far. I mean, there was more guys sporting C cups. You know, the women averaged probably a B-plus cup. The guys were averaging C and D size cups.
Well, it's the same thing. You know, it's the same thing as going to a nude beach. You think in theory, wow, this is going to be awesome. Then you realize, you remember, oh, yeah, 98% of the population is hideously unattractive.
Right. You saw Blame It on Rio one too many times and bought into the dream. And then you hit there, and it turns out it's the one. Yeah, it's some 50-something-year-old that looks like one of your mom's friends with the gray pubes.
Now you're upset. It's not just you're like, not only am I not excited about this now, I'm disgusted by this experience. And I'm sorry. Yes. How many times, Rachel, have you in public shown your bosoms?
I don't know. I mean, just randomly flash them. I'll flash them at like my friends. Does that count as public?
Sure it does. Keep going.
Well, no, you can't be indoors. You have to be out of doors.
Oh, I don't think ever.
Yeah, it's cold in Canada.
I don't buy it.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, if I could cite an example.
Yeah, well, think of one.
I've taken my pants off.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes.
Really?
I'm taking mine off now.
I was doing a photo shoot, like, in New York in, like, the lower, Soho, and there was nowhere to change. I mean, I had little boy short underwear on, but I had to change quickly. There was no one around. I just whipped my pants off. All right. Da-da-da.
All right. We had underpants on. Doesn't count.
And I dance.
Yeah.
What did
Rachel
I just say?
Rachel Berry, everyone.
Oh, I get wasted.
Dude, I get wasted and I dance.
Yeah, I do.
All right, we will take ourselves a little break. Big Tad is going to hit the streets. I think I'd like to revisit this hobo power thing. I'm infinitely fascinated by the hobo power stories. So
sure, it's appropriate because Bourbon Street, you know, around Mardi Gras, there are a lot of stenches to be smelled then.
This is our unit of stink measurement. Call us up at 866-901-ADAM. Tell us your greatest stinking story, and we'll be right back after this.
This is Doug Savant from Desperate Housewives. Give Adam a call at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Yes, you should. Big Tad is dressed up like a Girl Scout.
Hi, my name is Big Tad, and I'm your Girl Scout extraordinaire.
Yes, you're looking good, Big Tad.
Thank you.
You're wearing a skirt, right?
Yes, I am, and I'm wearing a sash, and I got this white T-shirt dress shirt that's showing the nipples. It's very cold in here. I got a beret. I'm good to go, and I got the cookies, too, so.
You look adorable.
Thank you.
Tad's going to hit the streets. He's going to be at the Coffee Bean, which is on 300 South La Cienega and 3rd. Isn't that the place where OJ's wife hung out or something before? I only have to do the OJ math here. It's near the Beverly Connection. That's right. La Cienega and 3rd. Beverly Connection. He's going to be there selling cookies. I got that list we looked at about a month ago that says the most popular of the Girl Scout cookies. Thin Mints is at the top.
I have those.
No surprise there. Samoa's coming in number two. Thin Mints, 25% of all the Girl Scout cookies sold. Those are nice. Put them in the freezer. Dip them in milk. Samoa's 19%. Here's where I have some problems. 13% the Tagalongs, the peanut butter patties, far superior. to the Thin Mints. Far superior.
Incorrect.
Now, not the peanut butter cookie. Now, here's the whole thing. They have the peanut butter cookie.
Those are Dosey Does.
What's the difference?
Yeah. Tad has them all tattooed on his forearms. He just checks them like a quarterback so he can audibleize every once in a while when the store's out of the Thin Mints. He goes to the wrist. Go with the Dosey Does. Checks off at the counter. Yeah, sorry. Go ahead, Rachel.
What do you mean the patty versus the cookie? One have the peanut butter cream inside?
One is, first off, you can do no better than peanut butter, in my guesstimation or estimation. No better than peanut butter when it comes to the candy dessert stuff. Not dessert. Not peanut butter pastry, but like peanut butter cups. Really? Everyone talks about all their favorite candy bars and stuff. I just say, ounce for ounce, nothing better than a peanut butter cup. So good, you can only eat about three or four of them. They're so rich, you get kind of burnt out on them. But for the first bite, that first bite.
What's great is Christmas time when they get the peanut butter trees and the peanut butter eggs at Easter.
Those are just awesome. Nothing better.
That's my favorite all-time candy bar is the Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, but I also love a Twix. When they put peanut butter in a Twix, I was the happiest person on the planet.
We gotta get high and get some Twix. or just get high. So, here's the deal. So, they have the peanut butter cookies, which are nice. They just have the cookie dough
and the peanut butter, you know, yeah.
Right.
With the peanut butter inside.
Yeah,
right.
The tag-alongs are the peanut butter sort of with the chocolate melted over them. Tad, go get a tag. Brusca, go get one of those boxes and show dear sweet Rachel. To me, better than the Thin Mints. And I like the Samoas better than the Thin Mints, too. But the Thin Mints are sort of the... Tad tried to leave his headphones on. Pulled him right back into the studio. Yeah, the Thin Mints are just the... I'm trying to think what they would be. They're the work truck of the cookies. They keep the country in cookies rolling. What I mean is they're not the frilly. They're interior linemen. No. They're a solid tight end with good hands. They're the Russ Francis of cookies. They're not flashy. There's no big, they don't try to put the juke move on you or anything. They'll run right over you. They're very solid and consistent. Put those back, Rachel.
But I like them.
You're wildly incorrect.
Really?
Yes, and you know as much.
I do.
I gave out my award to this. I did this at least a month or 6 weeks ago. Listen, the Samoas, as I said at the time, the Samoas try too hard. They're cloying.
No. Look at them. They're beautiful.
Yeah, listen, I can throw every kind of sweet thing into one cookie.
Yeah.
That's try too hard. Your peanut butter, it's a niche. It's a niche market. Let me tell you, here's what you do with the Thin Mints. Take some vanilla ice cream, crush up some Thin Mints.
Throwing in too many things. You're now incorporating a whole new dessert.
Let me just tell you something. You take the Thin Mints, you crush them up, throw them into some vanilla ice cream, and you've just stamped your ticket to heaven.
Wow.
Wait, I just tag-along, it's like, it looks like it's got some sort of a cookie with something on top covered by chocolate.
You never seen those?
No, it says peanut butter patties. Is that peanut butter or is that caramel? That must be peanut butter.
Well, why don't you taste
these.
One?
We
taste
should
one.
Open these and find
hey, wait,
out.
Wait, hold on. You got $4 for that?
$4.
$4?
Yes, and that's not Canadian either. That's real dollars.
Is there tax on that?
I need to make sure I get the money because Jimmy's on my ass for this whole thing.
That's right. Big Tad did not lose enough weight last week. That's why he's heading out there. But Rachel Perry, have you really not had one of those?
I don't think. No, I've never had any of these.
Me
well,
either.
I know you've had them all. But
I never had one either.
That's the best one. Enjoy the best one.
I can't say that I...
enjoy the best.
Oh, nothing.
Enjoy.
They smell peanut buttery good.
Yes.
Come
enjoy.
On, Dave.
Enjoy. All right, Tad, hit the road, please.
All right.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It's like an orgasm in your mouth, but not that kind of orgasm. You know what I'm saying?
This is better than that. This is better than an orgasm in my mouth.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, your orgasm in your mouth.
If I could have orgasms in my mouth
that
were like
I brought that up.
I would give a whole lot more. Can I even go there?
You know what I mean? That's delightful, is it not? Thank you. I'll take one myself. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, that wouldn't be the best marketing line.
It's like
the
orgasm in your mouth.
No, thank you.
But Dave, it's like I orgasm right in your mouth. I mean, we did. I mean, all the people at the factory.
Yeah, I'm a straight fella. I don't know. Doesn't intrigue me.
No, you misunderstand. It's like every one of the employees over at the Keebler factory in Van Nuys orgasmed in your mouth.
I mean, I'll pass.
No, you don't understand. It's like if God could orgasm right in your mouth.
If you could have some Girl Scouts orgasming in your mouth.
Yeah, if that was possible. Oh.
No, I want those ones too.
Like all right. I'll pay for those. That to his boss.
Yeah.
You're fired.
Oh, it's like a thousand angels orgasmed in your mouth simultaneously. All right. So Big Tad is hitting the streets. He's going over to the Coffee Bean, La Cienega, and 3rd Street, Beverly Center. Going to sell those cookies. Dave, did you taste? Tastes a little of the tag-along, though, and I think I know what a tag-along tastes like.
It's not as good as a Thin Mint. That's nice. Oh, it's not as good.
You can't
it's
say better. That I can't sway you with a Samoa.
Here's the thing. Let me say this.
Come to the other side.
First off, he makes his argument by having to sprinkle it over a bowl of ice cream. That's your argument for that cookie? But here's what I want to say. I'm good, Rachel. Thank you. Here's the thing. I would say there's a... The whole thing just capsized on the console. Engineer Ron's going to have to eat them tonight. So here's the thing. I agree. I think if you're sitting down, if you're hunkering down for the long haul, it's a long weekend and you're going to be eating nothing but Girl Scout cookies, maybe you go Thin Mint. One cookie for one cookie. I would say this. I'll get back to one of our sporting analogies. The Thin Mint is Sugar Ray Robinson. He dances, he moves, he peppers you with the jab. He's going to win. You can't stop. You may beat him the first round and the second round, but eventually his poise and stamina and rhythm are going to take you out. And at the end of the night, when you get to the 15th round, his arm is going to be held up victoriously. But if it's just a one-round fight, if it's just one of those tough man competitions, the tag-along, that's the haymaker. If you just have one cookie for one cookie, I think this is the one. And then the question is who gets those trefoils? Who gets just the shortbread ones? How low does your self-esteem have to be to go right past the Samoas and the Tagalongs and the Peanut and the Thin Mints? Now, give me the ones that just taste like plain. The ones I could get, by the way, I don't have to wait for Girl Scout season. I could get these any day. I'll just go to the Hostess thrift shop down there on Sherman Way in Saticoy and just go get some plain cookies. It really just tastes like what sugar and flour mold in it.
So you're saying you have an emotional problem if you get the trefoils?
I think, I just remember I was at a, we were talking about this a month ago, I was at a car place waiting for some tires to be changed or something, and the guy said, "Hey, want any Girl Scout? We got some Girl Scout cookies." And I said, "Oh, well, what have we here? Girl Scout cookies. I'll gladly enjoy some of those." And he pulled out the shortbread ones. I was ruined, by the way, and so was he, because I wouldn't let it go. Why would you? I don't know. She came by. We ordered cookies. Why the short? Why do they? You know what? Here's
Adam,
the thing,
he
though.
He was clearly holding out on you.
Yeah, but would you buy? You buy those as a sort of offering. Mm-hmm. To throw people, you know, you want any Girl Scout cookies? Sure. Hey, got the trefoils over here. I'm good. And then you put them away, and then they never get to the Samoas or the Thin Mints. Mm-hmm. Interesting. But if you're Girl Scouts, why do you even make those? Do you need to make those? We know they have crappy cookies. We can get those in the real world. We don't have to wait till once a year to buy those off your ass. All right. Oh, so many more things to talk about. We got all our hobo power stories here. The other thing that this brings to mind is all the dads. We bought them from the daughter of one of our friends, Rick, over at Kimmel, because he's in pimping for his daughter every year. Every year the guys come in, they got the Girl Scout cookies, they're selling them in advance for their daughters, and I'm only picturing my dad sometime in the 1970s going into his place of work, if in fact he happened to have a place in the 70s. I'm not sure. That may not have been a good decade for him work-wise. But going in and on behalf of my sister in pimping Girl Scout cookies, never in a million years. I don't think it used to exist. You know, back in those days, you know, like the Bewitched days where guys would wear thin ties to work and pull up in big blue GTOs, and guys would they drink martinis for lunch and stuff like that. Do you think anyone came in and sold stuff for their kids? Your kid had to get the stuff and then go sell it.
Door to door.
Maybe. That's a good question. I was going to bring this up, but Sheck beat me to it, which is maybe the whole door to door thing is what eliminated this. It used to be, get the kid on the bicycle, load the basket up with whatever the kid's pushing, and let him hit the road. Forget about a helmet. Forget about a cell phone. Forget about it. Just go start banging on doors. You wouldn't let your kid go door to door today. It's like kids get, they have to just sit around and work from the office inside the house with a grow light on them. So I'm going to raise my kid like I'm growing weed in the basement. Honey, Johnny's hydroponic pump is on the fritz. He's not getting the nourishment. He's starting to wilt. We got to get the grow light on a little bit longer. Growing like hydroponic weed.
He'll keep his
weed.
Nose clean that way.
Yeah, I just wonder if the day when kids stop being able to go door to door is the day when parents started bringing the cookies into work. But here's the thing. If your kid's a Girl Scout or your kid is selling stuff for the Pop Warner football, the Pee Wee baseball, whatever it is, just have them sell a box or two and call it good. They don't have to move several hundred pallets worth of the stuff, you know? Like, I mean, these guys are selling, I don't know how much, when we were over at Kimmel, when Rick would come in for his daughter, it seems like he would sell several hundred cartons of these things, right?
Yeah.
Kimmel, with just one wave of the hand just to get him out of his office, would buy a baker's dozen of these cartons. I mean, he'd buy 10 cases of the stuff just to get Rick to leave the office, just to take the hair plugs and get out of the office, right? Well, he knows he has hair plugs. Everyone who knows him knows he has hair plugs. Here's the other thing, too. If you have bad hair plugs, put a baseball cap on. Everyone's doing it. I have good hair plugs, and I put the cap on. Yes.
What a waste of all. That's like getting breast implants and wearing a turtleneck.
Yeah. Ooh. Although Adrian Barbeau used to fill one out pretty nicely in mod. I'm going back to my day. I'm going way back. But here's the thing. Well, yeah. That's another subject. I want to talk about hobo power for a second. Jason.
Yeah.
What's happening?
I used to work at a golf course. And the greenskeeper had a 14-foot Burmese python, and he had it in about a 3x4 homemade cage with a heat lamp on it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he went on vacation, fed the thing a couple of gerbils before he left, and they sat in his belly and cooked for a few days. Then the snake regurgitated them into the cage, and a couple of days later, one of the lawn mowing guys went in there into his workshop. As soon as he went in, just puked all over the place.
Uh-huh.
They called me to come check the situation out. I look in there, there's about an inch thick of gerbil juice, just liquefied gerbil, in the bottom of the cage with two hides in there, cooking under the heat lamp.
Oh, cooking under the heat lamp.
It's horrible.
And tell me about the enclosure itself. Was it outdoors or was it in a shed?
It was inside in a shed in a shop. It was wooden with plexiglass sides on it.
Uh-huh. Ooh, plexiglass. You got a little greenhouse effect going.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, that's nice. All right, let me see if I can put a hobo power number to this. Let's see. You got the gerbils that have been regurgitated, which is a nice twist. Instead of just passing away, they actually got brought in, half ingested, and then brought back out. And then you have the heat lamp cooking them. What month was it in?
I don't remember the month.
Well, what season?
It was in the summer.
So convenient.
And this is one of those metal garden sheds at a golf course.
Yeah. What city is it in?
This was in Rialto in San Bernardino County.
All right. Gets warm out there. I'm going to go ahead and how close did you get to the snake cage?
I had to pull the snake out of the cage.
You did? Why?
Yeah. There was dying in there.
Oh, okay. So you had to actually get the snake out. All right.
Yeah.
I'm going to give it a 48. And again, a 50 is a cat that's been fed nothing but blue cheese for a week, defecating on a white-hot hibachi. Yeah. Okay, Jason?
Yeah.
All right, but it didn't quite match that, but it's pretty good. And it's a nice twist. It's not just, a coroner had to pull an old body off the commode. This is snakes regurgitating. Hmm. Max? Max, you there? Wow, Max is a good one, too.
I think that's what hurt his case, actually, was the snake. We can't relate to how bad a snake would stink.
You know, it's weird. You don't think about reptile smell very often.
If it had been a cat or a dog, that would have really maybe pushed it up into the 60s, maybe.
Max, you got a hobo power story for us?
I do. How you doing, Adam?
Good. How you doing?
I'm all right.
Good. Let's hear it.
All right. I was in the Marine Corps for 4 years, and I was in Iraq in 2003. And they had built a bunch of commodes when we were finally in Iraq. And everybody crapped into a 55-gallon drum that was cut in half.
Mmm. And it was warm, right?
Oh, like 115 degrees all the time.
Yeah.
And basically what we had to do to get rid of it was burn it. And when you burn it, you have to stand over it and stir it up so it keeps it all burnt.
Oh, no.
Oh, that's a bad detail.
Yeah.
Wow. And how do you burn it? Just use gasoline?
We used gasoline. Yeah, we poured it on there, and then you just light it on fire, and you had to stir it for probably about an hour and a half till it was all burnt, and you just stand there and stir it all day. Oh.
So you're lucky you didn't go to war with Cousin Sal, because he would have taken an M80, he would have put it into a condom, and he would have eaten it, just so he could have crapped it out into the big dung bowl, and then when it was burning, whoever was standing there eventually would have blown up. That would be the greatest prank ever. All right, so were you stirring it? Did you have to stir it, Max?
Oh yeah, there was a couple times when I had to stand around and stir it.
All right, and it was 110, 115 degrees?
Oh yeah.
Lost a lot of good men on that mission.
Yeah, lost a lot of good fecal matter. I'm going to give you a 61.
Awesome.
That is solid. But I'll tell you the thing about smell. It's all about heat, which is weird. I mean, I guess it's just molecules speeding up or slowing down. But, I mean, when it's cold, nothing. Can't get anything. And when it's hot, everything stinks. So, ladybug breaks wind and it ranks out an entire room. When it's hot. When it's cold, nothing.
Well, moisture as well. A key component, the hobo factor.
Right.
You add some dampness in the equation. Much worse.
We'll continue rating the stink with my hobo power chart. Again, a unit of stink measurement. We have everything else. We have kilowatts. We have horsepower. We have BTUs. We don't have any measurement for stink. I came up with hobo power. I'm hoping it catches on. And by the way, this stuff I bring up, this is for you, society. Use it in your everyday life. Guy breaks wind while you're driving with him. Whoa, man, that was an 18 hobo power. And again, remember, 15, I should say 50, just so you can calibrate your hobo power compass. 50 is a cat defecating on a white-hot hibachi. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now at 866-901-ADAM. Good times.
Yeah, good times. Dr. Worm. They might be giants. I like this song. 866-901-ADAM's the phone number. We got some hobo power stories. Dan? Caller Dan? Dan? What's up?
Hey, one time I was in here in Central Oregon, ran for the Bureau of Land Management, and my grandfather and I drove an ATV onto about 25 cows that had been piling up in the summer heat.
Mm-hmm.
They were just rotten.
Yeah.
The thing is that the farmer, to get rid of them, tried to light them all on fire to burn it all down.
And
I don't know what the
hobo.
Yeah.
Well, let me see. Summertime, 25 corpses of cows, and although you are outdoors.
Right.
Burning cows, that smells like dinner.
Yeah, it smells like we're over at Kimmel's house on a Sunday. It's barbecuing. It's tough. You know, you're calling from Portland. I know it gets warm there, but it's just, you know, you're not in Death Valley. I'm going to give it a 31.
Oh, 31.
I'm sorry, Dan. And by the way, don't try to talk the hobo power number up. That it's the final. It's a final decision. And here's how it works. I've gotten into it before, not on the radio, but at home when I give my rendering. Well, the judge says that's a 31 hobo power. But Your Honor, you don't understand. These cows are... It's now 30. You want to go for 29? Because I'm the old gym coach used to do to you. I miss those days in America where someone would yell at you, like when your dad's friends or your dad or your gym coach, and would start at something, you know? But 2 hours detention. Well, it's now 3. You want to go for 4? 3 hours. Okay, mister. Now it's 4. You keep going. Remember that? Did parents do that anymore? Because I spent my entire childhood that's all he did is just haggle for detention time and grounding time and minus points. What? 9 minus points, Mr. Walters. Nope, it's not 9. It's now 10. You want to go for 11? But 13 and back to the corral, donkey.
I think that's a terrible lesson. I teach his kids not to stick up for themselves or argue. Yeah. Terrible lesson.
It's good, though, if you're... I do... That's the only reason I'm having kids. So I can do that. I can do that, and I can do that thing where we go to the amusement park and I pretend like we're leaving. Okay, then we're leaving! All right! Well, little Timmy, you have to make friends with another family and start a new life. You know, because we're leaving.
Have you worked out what your threat's going to be, by the way, when they're acting bad? Mine always was that they were going to take us to work camp.
Oh, really?
My parents used to say, fine. Well, yeah, we'll take you back. We'll take you to work camp, you know. And my sister, my little sister, I never bought it, but my little sister bought it.
Really?
Hook, yeah. Line, and sinker. She would cry. Camp. I don't want to go to work camp.
Poor camp.
That's terrible.
Ronnie?
Yes, sir.
You have a Vietnamese booby trap hobo power story?
Yes, sir. It was a piece of bamboo on a little, what we call an ankle breaker, piece of bamboo, and they would put them in the halls and they would defecate on them.
Oh, yeah.
And
so
one of
infection,
my men,
yeah,
stepped in the hall and one of them penetrated his boot into the side of his ankle.
Mm.
We pulled it out and tried to clean it out as best we could and bandage him up, and we're on a long-range patrol, and we had another 2 days in the bush, and after about another day and a half, almost 2 days, he could feel it. He said it was throbbing and it hurt, and took the bandage off and it was festering. It was bad, gangrenous. It was that smelled bad as
gangrene
was.
In the jungle. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's that smelled
son.
Bad as it was.
That's right.
But the only thing we could do really is we'd heat up a knife and laid the flat edge of the blade across.
Yeah,
the
like Pepillon.
Yeah. So I was one of the guys holding his leg. Steady.
And you got the little plume of festering gangrene smoke that came up.
Hit me in the face and I passed out.
Oh.
Won the Purple Heart, though. It's a good news.
Yeah.
All right. You know what? Because you're a veteran and because you're in country, I'm going to go ahead and toss on another 8 points to that one, just because I know we're not supposed to factor those things in. But the guy was knee deep, surrounded by Charlie in country. Probably bivouacking by the Mekong Delta. I'm gonna go ahead and give that a 54.
All right. Well, I beat the cat. All
yes,
right.
You beat the cat. It's
all
Americans
right.
like you that make
I
me
gotta
cry.
Say,
Semper Fi.
Sometimes you're a little harsh with your judgments because the man passed out from it. That's pretty good.
Yeah, but, you know, there was not, I mean, it was only a wound the size of, you know, a quarter on a guy's ankle. You know, I mean, it wasn't
concentrated
25
stink.
Cows. That's true. Concentrated hobo power. All right, we're going to take a break. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call him now. Now at 866-901-ABM.
Ted Casablancas here from E. We'll bring him in the studio, dish a little dirt, talk a little gossip, and also a little Oscar preview. We're finishing up with our hobo power. Tad is over at the Coffee Bean. Just finish up with a few hobo power stories here very quickly. Glenn?
Yes?
You have a hobo power story you'd like me to rate?
Absolutely. I was an EMT a couple of years ago, and we got a call, some neighbors calling 911 for this old lady they haven't seen come out of her house for a couple of days. And we get to this house, we have to break the door open, and there's like a cloud of scent in there. She's got the place sealed up to stay warm, but she actually had passed away while she was on the toilet and fell over onto one of those little space heaters.
No.
and had been draped over it for 3 days.
Oh, no.
Oh, wow. Now, was it one of the wall mount space heaters?
Yeah, it was just one of those ones that you set on the floor that you plug in. And she set it right next to the toilet. It was on it. And then by the time we got there, it was just juice.
Wow. So it was the winter time, but yet there was a source of heat. There was a space heater in the door. And how did you get her out of the bathroom?
Oh, well, you know, as the EMTs, we don't transport, you know, people who passed away. So we at that point, we just kind of call it and they wait for the coroners to come. But
now, do you have to establish that she's deceased by doing that thing where you put your hand on her neck for a tenth of a second and then go and then look up at your partner and shake your head?
No, you don't have to do it. If there's obvious signs of death, like rigor mortis or your body's melted,
right.
You know, yeah, you can call it right there.
Wow. But you got a good whiff, huh?
Oh, my gosh. You walk in the house and it hit you. It was like a wall as soon as you went through the door. It was just, wow.
So you knew there was something there and you had to just, you had to continue to go find it though, right?
Oh, well, yeah, you have to verify.
Okay.
Oh, man. It was
bad.
Worse.
All right. I'm going to put you into the mid-70s there. I'll give you 74 and a half.
Wow.
Yes.
Not quite 75 material, but 74 and a half.
74 is decent. I'll
solid.
Take
remember, you know what 50 is?
50 is a cat defecating on white hot hibachi.
After eating what for a week? Blue cheese. The cat is reared on a diet of exclusively of blue cheese and then defecates on a white hot hibachi. All right, a couple more just to finish it off. Lance?
Hey, how you doing, Ace?
Good.
Pretty good story here. Back in college about 22, 23 years ago, Thanksgiving break, so it's very hot out, very cold out. We have the heaters on. We go to a private party at a private college, a Catholic college. My buddy and I, a couple friends. This one guy's birthday party's crazy. He's acting crazy. It's his night crazy. So he passes out. So my best friend, he goes, hey, let's take a dump in a KFC bucket, right? So we take a dump in a bucket. My buddy gets... Now, this guy matches, I think, your cousin Sal. He gets it. He wipes it all over this guy. Oh, now, God. The heaters are on in the whole dormitory. The guy
he craps in a KFC bucket.
The guy wakes up with crap all over him. The whole...
All right, listen. No gay stuff. Eventually, you cross from hobo power into homo power. And that's where I draw the line. Although I'm working out a whole set of criteria for that. But this has crossed the line. Crap, I was with you, my friend, up until the point where you started smearing the fecal matter on your passed out friend. And I like the crapping in the KFC part. And I always have to explain the difference between men and women. And him passing out reminds me of that, which is when chicks are out, there's three or four chicks, and one of them just gets blottoed, like does too many Jello shots, starts vomiting all over the place, and then just hits the deck, just passed out, as my friends have done many, many times. Women are like, oh, my God, Tammy's sick. And then the other four start panicking a little, like, we should get her home into bed. No, we should take her to the hospital. She could be choking on her own, whatever. When a guy passes out, the four buddies look at him and go, all right, someone get some duct tape and a Sharpie. I'm going to see if I can work up a little whiz. I mean, this is the difference between men and women. One passes out, they start torturing. I mean, now it's just, he's a cadaver and we're all medical students. Let's party. Tape him to the, go get the folding chair, tape him to that. Kimmel, get the Sharpie. You can still draw the huge penis and sack, right? All right, get to work on that. Ray, get the camera. Yeah, this is how it works. Meanwhile, the guy's aspirated and he swallowed his own whatever and his lungs are filled with fluid. It doesn't matter. You're taking photographs of him.
Well, yes. By the way, actually, that's what caught my ear. You said homo power and this and that because they were putting wiping fecal matter on each other. Mm-hmm. And you seemed to not condone this. And yet, I've heard many a tale about you and your pals from high school doing just that.
I was a victim.
Tell the story of Ray. Of what Ray did to you once when you were talking to a girl.
In high school?
Yeah.
Sad. It was my senior year. We were in me and my buddy Chris and Ray all were in Mr. Spade's class. And he was an old guy, probably died 20 years ago. But we used to run wild out in the hall in the third period there. And I was running down the hall, and Ray was coming at me down the hall, and he looked suspicious. Ray's a guy who shouldn't be trusted, by the way, but especially back then.
More beast than man.
Yes, I noticed he was sort of had one hand suspiciously behind his back, like as he was high. The kind of thing you would do that if you're trying to throw a pie in somebody's face, that's how you would carry it if you were walking down the hall at them. And I thought, what the... And at the last second, I realized this was doom, and I tried to slide under him and get around him, and he slapped me in the side of the neck and ear with something that felt moist. Turns out it wasn't a pie. It was not just a tin filled with shaving cream. That would have been the greatest day of my life. Turned out he'd defecated on a napkin during school hour.
Man!
Area.
And he's an animal, this Ray! He pooped on a napkin.
It was still unclear whether it was his or Chris's, but the point is I got hit in the neck with this stuff. And it was one of these things where I thought, oh, I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill him, except for he could have always killed me because he was so much bigger and stronger. But I was like, I just saw red and brown simultaneously. I said, I'm going to kill him. So I started chasing him down the hall, but it was one of these things where we had the exact same foot speed, and he was about 15 feet ahead of me, and he was a perpetual 15 feet ahead of me throughout the entire school as I chased him through the quad and down the corridor and all that good stuff. And I finally realized I wasn't going to catch up to him, but I still had the fecal matter on the neck. So I sprinted back to my locker, and I took my jacket, and I put it over my head, and I snapped the one button, you know, the collar button up high, but I had it pulled over like I was in South Park, you know, just so I could see out of the collar. It was like some kind of...
Superhero ever.
Yes, crap man. It was a cape that I put over my head and snapped so nobody could see who I was, and I could just look out of the collar porthole. And then I started sprinting for the fence to get home because I knew I needed a shower. And there was a security guard by the fence, but I had such a head of steam when I hit the fence, he gave a little like hup hup, and I just flew right over the top of it, and I ran all the way home and took a shower.
You don't think that you thought you had to sneak out to get home? You couldn't just use that as there's crap on my head right now.
You know, it was one of those things where I didn't want to have a sit down and an explanation. There was a fair amount of paperwork that would have been involved.
Sure, there's shame involved in this.
Believe me, there would have been a phone call that needed to be made, an emergency card that needed to be looked. Is your dad's place of work? Is his business still the same? I didn't have time for all that. The crap was drying on my neck like a bad mud pack.
You didn't want to feel like a tattletale.
I gotta tell you a little insight to me. Do whatever you want to me. I don't want to go. You know the part where somebody like has something horrible happen to them, and then they go on Larry King and explain that that's the real part. That's the part I don't want to deal with. I would rather deal with the part where the person does the horrible thing to me than deal with the part where I go on Larry King and have a big discussion about it. That's the tough part.
This isn't a little practical joke. This was a crime. Ray could have done time for this one.
To me, it was just, I'd done many horrible. Later on, I got him back, so don't you.
Good for you.
Don't you worry.
An inspirational tale for the kids.
All right. Thank you for that music, though.
Beautiful.
Yeah, the more you know. All right. Big Tad is in at the Coffee Bean in Los Angeles. Tad?
Would you like to buy some Girl Scout cookies?
All right, Tad, stop pretending you're working.
No, actually, I had two people walking by. Hey, what's up, man?
Is it working?
I sold one box so far.
That's it?
It's early.
All right.
It's a slow process.
Okay, yeah, I understand. It's not an impulse buying the Girl Scout cookies. You stand around the table for a couple hours, you scratch your head, then you pay $1 and you put a down payment. That's $4 for a box, Dad.
Yeah, but it's hard to sell when you're dressed up as a Girl Scout and you're fat.
I would argue it's easier. But here's the thing. You're at the Coffee Bean on La Cienega and Third Street. Right. All right. So people can go down there across from the Beverly Center, right?
Yes, sir.
And
yes.
You've only sold one box.
Only sold one box. We got Samoas, we got lemon coolers, Do-Si-Dos, trefoils, sing-alongs.
Which one did you sell?
The Samoans.
Oh, really?
This should almost be a competition for us to see which cookie is the best.
Yeah. I think there are Samoas, by the way. Samoan is a culture.
Sorry, it's Samoa.
All right. But if there were Samoan cookies, they'd have huge calves. All right, we said we would speak to Rick, who's our buddy. Rick?
Hey.
What's happening, Rick?
Nothing. Hey, go ahead.
Rick's insane.
Yeah.
Rick, you're over at Jimmy Kimmel Live?
Yes.
Why?
Are you there already, Rick?
No, I'm getting ready. I'm taking my kid to school.
Oh, okay, you're in your car.
Yeah, well, we're standing by because my kid's a Girl Scout, in case you need more detailed information on the cookie.
Well, here's why I wanted, because you came to mind because we were talking about the fact that back in the day, I would get the little box of chocolates from the East Valley Trojan Pee Wee football team, and I have to just go and sell it, and I would sell 4 out of the 12, and that would be that. I'd give them $4, and that'd be that. You've sold, how many boxes did you sell last year?
This year so far, we've sold 357 boxes.
That's my point. Imagine my dad, who didn't even know what radio station I was on out here, imagine just the look on old man Carolla's face if 11-year-old Adam would have said, Dad, take these boxes in Newark and sell them. Could you imagine?
Yeah, well.
He would have raped me with one of the boxes.
It's a little bit like blackmail. You show up and you kind of cajole your coworkers.
I know, and then everyone feels like an a-hole because Rick's come by and he's selling it for his daughter and it's all for a good thing. How many did Kimmel buy?
Either 10 or 20.
That's my point. Then Kimmel buys 20. Now you got to buy at least 5. And if you buy just one box, oh my goodness, you may get fired. Yeah. Rick, so last year you sold how many?
How many last year, Isabella? 160. So
160 boxes. And this year you sold, what did you say, 350 what?
357, 197 boxes more.
Wow. All right, Rain Geek.
Yeah.
I was going to call you Rain Man, but that would have been too nice. All right, Rain Nerd. So 357 boxes. So you're basically selling like $1,600 worth of Girl Scout cookies.
$1,428.
Rain Nerd. All right. So listen, Rain Nerd, why? I mean, I know you love your daughter, but if you loved your daughter, you'd go home once in a while and hang out with her. Is this just compensation?
It's making up for me being at Kimmel all the time.
Listen, believe me, nobody wants you to go home and be with your daughter more than Kimmel, too, ironically. All right, Rick. I know you take that stuff personally.
It's okay.
You're a good worker, and I miss you.
Thanks. I miss you, too.
I really miss hanging out with Rick. All right, my brother. Say, give our love to Isabella. Now, how many, and why, so if Isabella sells, now how old is Isabella, 10?
11 in 2 months.
If Isabella sells the most cookies, does she get a reward?
What do you get? If you hit 500, you get to go to a thing?
500?
Here, hold on. Here's Isabella.
All right.
Hi.
Isabella?
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry for
it's
Rick.
Okay.
It's good to talk to you, Isabella.
Thank you. You too.
She's very smart. You should become emancipated in a few short years and get the hell out of that house. Tell you that. Tell Rick I said that. How about those hair plugs on your dad? Weird, huh?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's too bad he doesn't have one of those berets you guys wear. Hey, Isabella.
Uh-huh.
If you sell 500 boxes, what do you get?
You get to go to the Magic Castle for a party.
That's it?
What's the Magic Castle?
Yeah, I think so.
It's a refrigerator box one of the pedophile dads has in the backyard. It's not the Magic Castle. This is just a refrigerator. They did it up with some crayons pretty good. Hung some Duvetine over it. There's a hole in the back of the Magic. I don't want to get into it. Isabella?
Uh-huh.
That's it? Just going to the Magic Castle for a party?
Yeah, but you also get all the prizes that you've already earned.
What other prizes can you earn?
There's a lava lamp. You get money. Ah. You get a hat. You get a pen. You get,
Wow, diabolical. So do you think you'll get to 500?
I don't know.
Well, you're 357 and we barely got started, right?
Yeah.
Now, how many of those did Daddy sell?
None.
None?
No.
What do you mean? He goes over to Kimmel and sells them. I saw him every year selling them over at Kimmel.
That was me.
That was you?
Yeah.
Well, he brings you in, though. He opens the door, and then you just shoot him those big brown eyes, and everyone's wallets just fold open, right?
Uh-huh.
All right, baby doll. So you're not giving Dad any credit for selling the cookies at work?
Well, yeah, but I sold them mostly.
Right. I mean, you both did it together. I'm just saying my dad would have never taken me into his work had he had a job. All right. We bought $380 worth for Big Tad?
Yeah. I went to Rick's house over the weekend. Wow. And it was Rick who gave us the cookies, not Isabella.
Wow. Isabella. Yeah, Isabella, your dad, Rick, gave us $380 worth of cookies to do our little experiment. You're not even giving him credit for it.
I was at school.
All right. Wow. It's a tough audience. All right, Isabella.
Uh-huh.
Give the phone back to your dad. And do you call him Rick?
What?
I'd appreciate you calling him Rick.
Okay.
You know how Bart calls Homer, Homer?
Uh-huh.
Can you call Rick, Rick, instead of Dad?
Okay.
All right, now say, phone Rick.
Phone Rick.
Good.
Hello.
What's happening, Rick?
Nothing.
All right. I miss you.
Well, Rick calls, Rick doesn't call her Isabella. What do you call her, Rick?
The girl, usually.
Hello, the girl.
All right, have fun.
Thanks.
All right, thanks, Rick.
All right, bye-bye.
Good times. Well, we got to take a break. Big Tad's over at the Coffee Bean across from the Beverly Center. We got 380 bucks worth of Girl Scout cookies we're going to try to have them sell. Ted Casablancas here from E to do a little gossip and talk a little Oscar talk. We'll do that after this.
Hey, it's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now. 866-901-ADAM.
Whatever. Yeah. Ted Casablancas is here. Ted is from E. The Awful Truth online at E.com. E seems like it's been picking up momentum and turning into a cable juggernaut over the last few months even. I was going to say years. E's always been around, but have they grown? I don't know what the ratings are. I don't know how it works, but it seems like we're hearing more E! Entertainment talk over the last 6 months than I heard in the prior 6 years.
A juggernaut of hairdos, perhaps,
yes.
Do you think? Ryan's hair and my hair, it's getting yeah. pretty big these days, right?
Yeah.
Although I've been trimming mine down, Adam.
I like Ryan Seacrest, or I don't not like him. I think maybe it's because everyone seems to not like him. I've decided it'd be cool.
Oh, Ryan's great. And his hair's better than Star Jones, don't you think?
Yes, and I know, in fact, that he's straight, by the way.
I wasn't asking.
I know.
Because he turned you down.
Yes.
And someone would have
Adam,
to be straight to turn you down.
How many times did you ask?
My gentleman only asked a baker's dozen times. That's what my father always said to me. And then you stop asking and start begging. That's what my dad always said. I was at some thing. I don't know where the hell we were. It must have been 8 years ago. Ryan Seacrest was not the Ryan Seacrest you know today. I think he was just the guy from Star Radio. And this could have been 10 years ago. And we were at some party or something. And we weren't good buddies or anything, but we were just talking. And he was feverishly trying to pick up on some hot blonde chick. This is before he had to live down any rumors or anything like that. So that's how I know. He's straight. He was trying to hit on a very attractive blonde-haired woman.
And were you taking notes? Were you doing hitting yourself?
No, I was not doing any hitting, but I was taking notes of his hitting and thinking, yes, this is how a straight man would do it. Yes. Ted, you're not straight,
you know,
are you?
Why don't we do the Oscars? Because it's a
yes.
total figula year.
Yeah.
It's gay for pay. It's hire a straight at the Academy Awards, don't you think?
I was watching all the, Capote and Brokeback Mountain and Crash and everything.
Have
good
you
night,
seen them
good
all?
Luck. No, I've seen none of them, which is sad.
You and most of the country.
I know.
We are in danger this year of low ratings.
You want to know what an intellectual lightweight I am? I was on the pot, had a little stomach problem over the weekend, and sat
on
around.
The pot?
Yeah, I mean, I don't mean on the weed.
Okay.
I mean physically defecating into a bong. And I rented that movie.
What do you read when you're on the pod?
Oh, I don't read. I don't bring reading material into the bathroom because I'll tell you why. Because that's why people spend an hour on the toilets, not because they're backed up. It's because they found some good reading.
So what do you do on the pod?
I do my business. I get the hell out of there. I barely bend at the knee. I barely bend at the knee.
Rachel, what about you?
I like a little reading.
Me too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I catch up on things.
I think it makes you soft.
I'm sorry. Interrupted your story.
No,
that's
all right. I was just saying that I didn't see any of the Oscar-nominated movies, but I rented that movie I bought on pay-per-view, Into the Blue. What was that one about Jessica Alba?
Oh, yeah.
And Into the Blue.
That looks dreadful.
They're like pirates who are underwater the whole time. Came out about a year ago, came and went. Not a lot of Oscar buzz around it, but a nothing movie. I'm an intellectual lightweight is what I'm saying. I don't like good. I like bad. But it
so
has
are you
to be
gonna
real
watch
bad.
The Oscars?
I will.
You like Jon Stewart, don't you?
He's a dear, dear friend of mine, actually. Yeah. So we'll and we have the same agent. James Baby Doll Dixon. So, we'll,
but people are going to be merciless with him. You know, it's just like they love to fry the host. The host can never do it right.
But don't you think that he is...
I think he'll do a great job, but I think middle America is going to say, oh, no, it's like he's too dry for my taste. I want Billy Crystal. So yeah, people are afraid of the edge.
But do we ever listen to middle America? And we don't listen to these people.
When it comes to cable ratings.
Yeah, let them eat cake.
Yeah, the advertisers on the Oscars sure listen, I'll tell you.
Well, they do, but what I mean is when it comes to the hipsters and the, you know, the blue states, Jon Stewart is sort of the darling of these people, right?
So you think it's going to be ratings gold this year?
Here's what I think. No, I don't think it'll be ratings gold, but I don't think the host is going to get blamed for that per se. I think they'll probably just say it'll be sort of like the winter. It'll be like the Winter Olympics.
They blamed
David
Letterman.
Did they blame him?
Oh, yeah.
Really? He was so good at it, too.
Absolutely.
He didn't think so.
Oh, yeah. The Oprah Uma thing haunts him to this day, yeah. Although it's overstated that he was terrible.
My favorite was Whoopi Goldberg.
Really?
I thought she was awesome. I think they need a ride-on gal to do it.
I don't find her funny at all.
Queen Latifah would be awesome. Why don't you like Whoopi?
I think she's sort of a blowhard. I think she's not all that funny. I think she's talented, but not all that funny. It's kind of weird. There's people that I think are really talented and then not all that funny. Like, she's definitely one of them. Most of the folks from Comedy 8 or whatever the hell that show was. What happened to that show?
The Relief.
The Comedy Relief, yeah.
Well, she was great in Ghost.
Flopping, dude-driven media. I mean, it's like, Rachel, what are you, news girl? How offensive is that? It should be newswoman, right?
Yeah, I fall somewhere in between. And news, really, I would argue with news opposed to girl.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure I give any of that.
So you're gossip woman.
So you're...
No, not really that.
Are you
really
doing
that.
My gig?
No. I would just say that I hardly get the facts right. I don't know. I can't be trusted.
Ted, yes, you can. Who are you picking to win?
Oh, it's going to be Fegula's all the way. I think Brokeback is going to, you know, Spittle Me Quick. That movie is going to take everything. Possibly even actor Heath Ledger. But I think it will be Philip Seymour Hoffman for Capote. Mm. Another total Fegula performance. I mean, it's such a pansy year. I'm so excited. I can't even talk.
Well, I'm
also,
straight,
Felicity
but I'm
Huffman
too.
Is going to take it for Transamerica. You're looking at
really?
Me like you haven't seen any of these movies.
Really?
Right?
No, do you really think, though, Brokeback Mountain? I mean, Crash seems to be getting all the
Crash
buzz.
Will get script. That's it.
Ah.
Unless Dylan sneaks in and gets best supporting, he's very well liked. But you know who I think is going to get supporting? Is Paul Giamatti. Because there's the leftover from Sideways.
Yeah,
people love him. And Clooney may be right. You know, he's saying he's not going to get anything.
Mm-hmm.
And he's so pretty. You know, it's like, you know, the Academy hates you if you have too much of one thing. Like Spielberg, he had too much money for years, and he never got anything, of course, until his conscience gave in.
You know, it's an interesting thing I was thinking about with Paul Giamatti, which is, I wonder if you get credit for playing drastically different roles from year to year. You probably do. You know, in Sideways,
Absolutely.
He was this loser teacher. And then you go to Cinderella Man. He's a guy from the 40s who's like the, you know, manager of the Cinderella fighter.
So don't forget him as Dr. Zaius in Apes.
That's true.
The Apes remake. Also, this is where politics come in, because people are sick of Russell Crowe, and they would just love to see Paul Giamatti win, and Crowe wasn't even nominated.
Yeah.
You know, his temper got the best of him. But politics always comes into it. Also, Reese Witherspoon just might take it for Walk the Line. Did you see that? You got
it.
You saw that.
I didn't
see anything. I saw Into the Blue.
Man, this is embarrassing.
I know.
Comes
it's
out on
sad.
DVD tomorrow. We'll pick it up for
you. Let me tell you, I've seen them all.
Yes.
And you know what is a great picture that was completely ignored? Sin City. How about that one?
That's
that was a
comic
good picture.
Yeah.
That was good.
Oh.
No, it's not Oscar stuff. It's not the stuff that the Academy voters like to nominate.
Not
they
into
like to nominate
books.
People for playing tragic roles, gays who get beat up, you know, transvestites and fey authors.
Yeah.
It's considered, if you're a woman, if you play a hooker, you get an Oscar or an Oscar nomination. And if you play a fag, you get an
or
Oscar or an Oscar nomination.
Wow.
It's the Academy's terribly predictable in that way.
Ted, let's
ask Tom Hanks this. He'll tell you the same thing.
I wish we could. Mike, book Hanks, would you?
Yeah, get Hanks on here.
See if you can get him in for the 6 o'clock hour. We're pretty booked up tomorrow. Ted, let's dish a little dirt on some of the Hollywood celebrities.
Yeah, Britney Spears, she's balling all over the place.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
what's
absolutely
going on?
That's B-A-W-L-I-N-G.
Uh-huh.
She's not playing basketball, is what you're saying.
What's your going point on? Yeah, what's going on
How
with
do you
her?
Don't do this early in the morning?
Oh, we don't.
Do you even
Isn't
go to bed?
Claire? Is she going to get into trouble with that whole baby on her lap thing?
She's done what Clinton should have done. She said, hey, I'm sorry. She told me it is what it is. But she has said she, you know, she's copped to it.
But you kibitz with her regularly.
If she had said, off and on.
Really?
You know what? If she had said, oh, the car wasn't moving, or come up with some PR story, which actually her publicist normally does,
right?
She would have been crucified for it. But she's admitted guilt, which no one does in this town.
Mm-hmm. Who's worse,
it's like
by the
Lohan.
Way?
You know, they have the same publicist.
Right.
What is this? You know, when she's going like 100 miles an hour, according to my sources, Dan Robertson. But no, she was going within the speed limit, says the LAPD.
No,
I mean, that's such BS.
They do that all the time, and then they just draw more heat on themselves. It would go away immediately. They could defuse it by just saying the truth. Who's worse, publicists or pedophiles? They both start with a P.
That's a tough one.
It is difficult, isn't it?
I'm going to have to say that's 50-50.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Wow. And Lindsay Lohan.
I mean, come on. Eddie Murphy, the greatest publicist story of all time. He was just being a good Samaritan at 4 in the morning with that transvestite. Where do they come up with this stuff?
Well, there's not a lot to choose from. You know, when you have these kind of stories, although they never do, they should just do like aneurysm. The guy, a vessel in his brain popped and he went nuts. You know, why do that thing where he's lending a helping hand, especially when everyone who's ever worked with him tells you what an a-hole he was.
I tell you, it's no mistake these days that Tom Cruise has hired the same publicist who came up with that beauty.
Now, what about Tom Cruise? What do you think about Tom Cruise?
At least he sort of backed off on telling women what they should do with their bodies. I mean, that was dangerous territory.
You're talking about with Brooke Shields?
Brooke Shields, yeah. Should be just going to, what, meditation, vitamins, instead of taking drugs
for postpartum
depression.
He's preachy, but is he gay?
Well, you seem to know everything. You know it about Ryan, that he's not. So you must have seen Cruise, like, trying to pick up on some chick at some point down in Manhattan Beach or something.
No.
So let's ask you, Adam.
No, let's ask you, because I don't know. I can't figure it out. On one hand, there's two schools of thought. Why would everyone keep talking about it if it wasn't true? On the other hand, isn't that how rumors work?
Absolutely.
Do you think there's anything definitive? Is there some tape somewhere? Is there some photograph? Is there something in the bowels of the Celebrity Center of Scientology that they have on him?
I've heard that there is.
Really?
Yeah, I've heard that. That they make you, like, when you become a Scientologist, that they make you fill out all these forms and then they record your conversations.
Hey, listen, Tom hasn't asked me to sleep with him. That's all I can say.
Wait, you're gay? You have gaydar?
How did you know I was gay? Is it the hair?
I can smell
you. Did it give me away?
But
I cut it off. I don't do the highlights
anymore.
My
spidey sense was tingling.
Hey, Tom's hair is very moosed.
Yes.
I don't know.
Yeah.
That smells a little...
That's not moose.
Smells a little figula. Not moose? What is it?
Oh, well. You do the gay math. Hold on. We need to take a break.
Is it love juice of some kind?
I'm going to let Ted do the gay math.
Ow!
I'm going to go into the bathroom and do my own gay math with Dave Damashek. We'll be right back with Ted Casablanca from E! Dish and Dirt. I want to talk more celebrities after this.
It's getting smelly.
Now at 866-901-ADAM.
Mm-hmm. Ted Casablanca in here. Does a little gossip. Has a gossip column for E! Online.
Hey, also, do you have some deodorizer? It's getting pretty stinky in here.
That was me. Did you hear about my hobo power system?
Oh, yeah, I did.
Powerful.
Not for you.
Not for you?
Yeah, I can do it if you want. I mean, you want to do Britney or Stinkorama stuff?
I'd rather do Britney, and I'd like to fold her into the
it's
hobo power story.
Pretty much over at Britneyville, I'll tell you.
What's going on with Britney Spears?
Well, she's just like everywhere she is. She's just crying nonstop.
What's she crying about?
The marriage is over.
Mm, really?
It's completely over.
Why?
She's in Hawaii. She's not wearing her ring. He's seeing... Well, he's doing the same thing, like, with Ryan Seacrest. He's been, like, with gals. Like, when you saw Ryan, he's been out with gorgeous gals. He was doing that when their marriage was supposedly solid. He does the club scene
right.
with all these hot chicks, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like, how would you like it if your wife went out with all these stud muffins to the Cabana Club and lobby and everywhere? I mean, whoa.
Well, do we get to get divorced and then I get to bang 18-year-olds? Because the first part of it I don't like, but eventually we're going to get to the part where I'm enjoying to myself.
As you might think.
What about...
For him?
But she's knocked up, though,
really?
Right?
Oh, yeah. So what?
Is she pregnant?
He's not wanting this to end, I'll tell you.
Oh, really?
But I think she's had it.
Well, he's
smart
not acting
girl.
Like it.
Could you believe being married to this guy?
I just want to take her and, like, be her friend just so I can tell her stuff. What are you doing?
Well, she's trying to get her career back on track.
But let me ask this. Does she possess any discernible talent?
Sure.
I mean, any more so than any
like
other?
Not as much as Madonna, but she's got talent. She's a great dancer. She's a great performer. She's not a great singer.
Right.
But if she wanted to pull a Madonna or mm-hmm. a Cher and electronicize her voice out the wazoo and get a bunch of backup dancers behind
well,
her,
well, that's all I'm saying. I know, but don't... I guess what I'm thinking is, with the Britney Spears of the world, it feels like they have one shot and they need to sort of strike while the iron is hot, and that was 7 years ago. And now all the teeny boppers that were into her when she was 17 aren't going to be into her when they're 25. I mean, she doesn't have... To me, it's like she doesn't have the chops to do it.
I don't agree. I think the only thing America loves more than to tear people up is a comeback.
Yeah.
They want to see her come back, shed K-Fed,
right.
and come back
but,
with some cool
but
single.
Here's my feeling... Sorry to cut you off. I knew we were going. That's why I did it. But there's like people like Mariah Carey. Mariah Carey has
She's
chops.
Got great
she has...
Pipes.
Yes, she has the horsepower to do it.
But a woman
yes.
who can't sing nearly as well stole the Grammys from her.
Who's that?
Madonna.
Yeah.
Yeah, and can
so,
you
come
say
on, it's
you
about
have,
show business.
Can you say you have a Mariah out? Who would you rather listen to, Mariah or Britney? Who would you rather go see in concert?
Mariah.
Really? Ugh.
Britney. Well, first off, Britney.
You got to be kidding.
I think a Britney concert would be far more entertaining.
Well, hold on a second. Well, entertaining. I'll go with Big Tan. We'll watch
God,
the monster
really
truck.
This guy's really straight, isn't he? I can tell it now. He wants to go to Mariah
no, look,
concert.
I saw. Well, you gave me a choice between Britney and Mariah. Give me a choice between Coldplay and Britney or Mariah or whoever. The point is I saw her HBO concert special. She ran up a flight of stairs that were 130. They went to heaven. They're 170 feet long, and she got, you couldn't even hear her breathing. It was that lip synced. She literally ran up with one of those mics that's attached to your head, like, you know, they work at
but
the
it's
drive-thru.
About looking at her tush while she's running.
She's not that hot.
She was.
Oh, look,
she could be hot again.
In Hollywood, she's a solid 6.5 to 7. Maybe. There's
and
so
where
many.
Where would you put yourself, Adam?
Here's the point. I don't have to look good. I just have to have a wallet filled with money.
I'd say you're a solid 7.5.
Here's
easy.
My point. Now look. Here's what I'm saying. Defending Britney for a second. She has mediocre talent.
I'm gay. What do you expect?
Mediocre. Okay. But here's the thing
we
about
love
Madonna.
The Britney. We love the Madonna. We love the Cher.
I understand. Madonna doesn't have the world's greatest voice, but she's an artist. She's an innovator. She's very interesting. She constantly evolves, goes many different directions, and crafts interesting songs. I'll give her that. Brittany is, if you go to any party on any given night in this city, you'll see 20 chicks that are much hotter than Brittany. And she's not a very good singer and doesn't seem to be a great songwriter. Yeah. So what is it?
Well, you're preaching to the choir, but the fact is that we're fascinated by her still. I'm still fascinated by her, by knowing what Brittany is doing.
Yeah. I like the rebel in Britney. And, you know, that's what K-Fed was all about. It was getting back at her mother. It was getting back at the public who was telling her who she had
expensive
to marry
mistake.
And how she had to be.
Yeah.
And now we're going to see her rebel again against him. And it's cyclical, and it's interesting, and she's going to reinvent herself, and it's what Hollywood does best, and it's what America loves.
But I just think she's a hillbilly that has almost no...
Of course she is. That's why she's cool.
She's a stupid chick from Florida that has no talent.
You know, Madonna's from Detroit.
Madonna has a ton of talent. She has no talent. That's the difference.
I think we all know that K-Fed has some talent. What is this?
To not wash his hair.
How can you not say... She's going to leave him.
That's true.
And then this is going to blow up. And she's going to miss out on the millions from Popo Zal?
I'll tell you, to me, K-Fed is on my list because he desecrated a Ferrari's brake calipers by taking off the word Ferrari and putting Federline onto the brake caliper of a Ferrari. And to me, that's like someone walking into to a graveyard and urinating on your grandfather's headstone.
This is what keeps you up at night.
Yes, he took the brakes of his Ferrari and took the Ferrari off and put Federline on.
Why don't you
That's
challenge
where we parted
him to a
ways.
Boxing match?
We should.
Ted, quickly. You said Corolla's a 7.5. Rate the fellas in the studio real fast. This is an ongoing debate that we have.
But Adam's a star. He's the only one.
You've got to eliminate that. You got to wipe that clean. Listen, here's what happens. These four, me, Corolla, Lynch over there, Brusca right there. The four of us walk into a bar. All right?
And
you've
me, too.
You've never seen us before.
I want to be on the
you've
list,
You've never
too.
Seen us, all right? You don't know. You got to put right. out the stardom. Left. Out of your head.
There's the scenario. You're down at Cuffs and Silver Lake having a smart cocktail, and we come walking in.
Now,
Not the Abbey in WeHo.
Right, the Abbey in WeHo.
Now, you have to say, who's the best? You say, now, right away.
Well,
1 through 4.
I got to tell you, I used to sleep with women, so I'd pick Rachel.
Yes!
Wow.
I'd go back to my
house.
Going all the way back
that's
to junior
high.
That's
the board up.
That's junk.
All right, I want to thank Ted Casablanca for coming in because we got to take ourselves.
Get rid of Ted.
No.
Hey, he fixed the babe.
No,
oh,
we got Neil Patrick Harris. Speaking of hot dudes, he's out in the green room.
Hey, what did you ask Neil
in.
About Tom Cruise and Ryan Seacrest?
Do you think he knows?
I think you just like ought to keep this ongoing.
Oh, really?
All morning.
All right. We can find you where? On the red carpet on Sunday at 5:30 on
Absolutely.
E?
Absolutely. www.eonline and all over E on the big Oscar day. And it's going to be a great show.
Come back.
And you get back to me and let me know what Neil says. I want to put it in my column, Adam.
All right. You dish the dirt anytime you want. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now at 866-901-ADAM. Let's do this.
Yes, let's. 866-901-ADAM. Neil Patrick Harris in studio. How I Met Your Mother. Name of the show. Monday nights. Tonight, 8:30 on CBS. Nice to meet you, Neil.
You too, sir. Thank you. Big fan.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Love the show.
Well, thanks.
Listen to it on my morning ride to work.
I'm sure I haven't met you, so I did the nice to meet you. I have done the nice to meet you a few times with people I'd met multiple times. So I now usually change it to good to see you, which can be interpreted many different ways.
Either way, I did the same thing.
I met Janine Garofalo 4 times, and I said nice to meet you. And she said, I've done Loveline, the TV show, twice, and this will be the 3rd time I'm doing the radio show. And I said, well.
Oh, wait, I've done the TV show.
Oh, really?
I did the TV show once.
God damn it.
I didn't even remember that. You too. How
yeah.
are you?
Good to see you. And were you plugging Doogie Howser at the time?
Gosh.
Starship Troopers.
No. That's exactly right. Starship
Maybe
Troopers.
It was. Awesome. I was on a short-lived NBC series called Stark Raving Mad for a season, so I might have been pimping that.
Could have been it, you know, 99, 2000, somewhere
2000,
in there.
Yeah, exactly.
We all love Starship Troopers.
That was a cool movie.
It really was, and it was one of these movies that I don't know if people don't feel comfortable saying how much they liked it. They feel like, I don't know, it was lightweight or because it had insects in it, they shouldn't dig it, or because of the name was sort of corny, or the whole movie was a little bit tongue-in-cheek. People aren't sure whether it's okay to say, I like that or not. Like when me and Jimmy both discovered that we liked Alf at the same time, and we had to admit to each other, like, we go, well, there's this sitcom I think is kind of funny. Not that funny, but you go first. we both said Alf simultaneously, and well, it hung our heads. Well, that's Alf. The point. I think maybe Starship Troopers is to sci-fi what Alf is to sitcoms. Everyone seemed to like it, but people are a little scared to talk about it.
The effects were a little bit better, I think, on Troopers.
Yes. It wasn't just a guy with his hand in a sock. Yes, I love that movie.
It was pretty cool.
And I discovered Denise Richards on that movie.
Yeah. How could you not?
And I really, this is where I claim that I discovered her first. I was like, you see, I was into her. See, now she's mine. That must have been nice.
I worked with her twice. Three times, actually.
What'd you work with her on?
She was an Undercover Brother that I did as well. Mm-hmm. And she was on a very special Doogie Howser episode.
She was?
A blind date episode.
Oh. Yeah. Jeez, I missed that one. She must have been spectacular. What was she? Was she 16 or 17 at the time?
Yeah, a youngster.
You got...
Wow. Nice, old school.
Is this Doogie?
Bring it. That's the theme.
You got...
Mike Post.
You got Doogie Howser when you were 16, right?
Yeah, 15 turning 16.
And you were going to school in Albuquerque at the time?
Indeed I was, yeah.
Same school that Freddie Prinze Jr. went
to. That's right, La Cueva High School.
It's all coming back to you now.
La Cueva Star Academy. They just crank out celebrities over there at La Cueva. And you came out... How did this work? You came out, did an audition for it?
Yeah, well, my first movie was a movie called Clara's Heart with Whoopi Goldberg.
Yes.
And she played a Jamaican maid, housekeeper, and I was the spoiled...
With Leota, right?
No, that was another...
That was another black maid, spoiled kid.
She's
thing.
Got the market on those. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was my first gig, and then I sort of... I was 12 or 13, mm-hmm. and ended up then getting an agent, and then there I was. I met the casting director and met Stephen Bochco... like a year before it actually happened.
How many seasons did Doogie last?
Four.
Doogie?
97. They're coming out on DVD now.
Wow.
That was pretty cool.
I was in love with Doogie.
Right on.
Is it a syndicated?
No, actually in love with him. I just told Adam I wanted to marry Doogie.
Yeah, wow. But that wouldn't have pissed off your dad enough. So you had to scrap that and go with the soap stuff.
Can't marry a prodigy doctor.
Yeah.
I mean, it would
be cool, but your dad would probably like it.
I get so many pissed off doctors who come to me who look young, like youngish looking.
Oh, they were all called?
Residents who are called Doogie.
Doogie in high school.
Horrible stare in their eyes.
The thing about Doogie Howser is, I think... Would you please stop that? I can't talk. couple of thoughts. One is once in a while a show comes along that just sort of transcends whatever. Just everyone knew Doogie Howser. I don't even know. I'm sure the ratings were good.
They were decent, yeah.
But there are other shows that were around at the time that probably did as well that no one talks about anymore, no one references anymore. It's weird when you become that show and then when you become that guy that everyone is talking about.
Yeah, it's been truly strange, the phenomenon of that name.
But can I say, speaking of transcending, you've pulled off some feat by transcending not just your child stardom, and now you're a star as an adult. You've even transcended being Doogie. You know, your name is Doogie. That's some feat you've done. Yes?
Yes, I still get called it. I had there were 10, 11-year-old kids that were said, aren't you Doogie Howser? The show's been off the air since 94.
Have they been syndicating it?
It was syndicated for a couple years, but now it's been seven or eight since it has been. I don't know, just the name.
Do you feel like you motivated young kids to go into the medical profession? That's the important thing.
I think I fueled the blog.
Good.
Remember the typing at the end of the show?
Sure. Yeah. Sarah Jessica Parker gets all the credit,
yeah, exactly.
But you're the one who really blazed that trail.
Thank you. I agree. I concur.
Ryan. All right. Oh, yeah. We're talking. I got a note here that Busey's kid, Jake, was in Starship Troopers.
And Jake Busey and I have the same exact birthday.
Wow.
Coincidence? I hope so.
You better hope, because if Gary confuses the two of you and decides to spank you 32 times or whatever your next birthday is, it's going to be bad news for you.
In the name of Jesus.
But, you know, Jake Busey's not crazy yet, is he?
No, not at all.
He's very semi-sane.
Nice guy. Very sane.
Yeah, but I'm just wondering if he's going to go down that road.
There could be some cracks in there, you know. You never know.
Because I think Gary Busey was relatively sane in his 30s as well.
Sanity is genetic, isn't it?
Yeah. I think so. Well, you're a doctor. You would know. So you have a hobo power story for us?
I have a minor hobo power story. I was trying to find an apartment in New York to live in. Mm-hmm. And when you look in the nicer areas, Midtown, Upper West Side, that you get a tiny little nothing apartment, one room, boring apartment for thousands and thousands of dollars a month.
Right.
So I had to go way uptown, lower Harlem. Found a place on 116th Street.
Mm-hmm.
And a woman who had been living there for about 50 years had just passed or gotten sick and had to leave. And I was able to see it before it had all been cleaned out.
Mm-hmm.
And it is the apartment that I have. It's great. Three bedrooms, long hallway, really nice. But when I went to look at it, it was horrible. The kitchen, all the electricity had been turned off. Mm-hmm. The kitchen was still covered with food remnants.
Yeah.
Flies about.
Is there
everywhere, like a bad sci-fi movie?
Old lady. What month?
There was old lady
smell. What month are we in?
What month of the year?
Ooh, yeah.
Good question. I think it was early summer.
Okay.
May,
all right,
June.
We're into the summer. That's good.
The back bedroom was the room she used to store her bags of trash. So what, floor to wall, this entire bedroom was full of giant black garbage sacks of stink.
Mm-hmm. So she was nuts. She's old, no air. June.
Flies
Harlem.
In the fridge full of...
Anything weird in the, on top of the stove, you know? Did she collect bacon fat or anything like that?
Ooh. The whole kitchen was
help.
A bit of a disaster. There was an upright refrigerator... One of the ones that you slide up the top open?
Oh, one of those, like the thing that...
Yeah,
guys keep bodies in.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And since the electricity had been turned off, that you didn't even want to go near that.
It was terrible. It was like some sort of mire.
An additional refrigerator that she had. She had the upright refrigerator.
Mm-hmm.
An additional refrigerator that was this slit.
Right.
Must have been for body parts.
Good. Good.
How am I doing?
It's good.
Am
I'm going
to have like 50, 60 maybe?
No, I'm sorry.
Nowhere near.
Well, 50 is a cat that's done nothing but eat blue cheese for a week defecating on a white hot hibachi and the plume of smoke that comes off of the
that's
hibachi.
That's a 50?
That's only a 50.
Good night.
Well, it is a good night. Good morning. Yeah, well, 100 is hypothetical. No man has ever lived.
All right.
Some claim they've smelled 100, but they're in the ground. And as you know, dead men tell no tales.
True.
So I'm going to give that, I'm going to give it a 22.
All right.
Don't hang your head.
It was off the top of my head. That's all I could come up with.
That's solid, especially in the celebrity department, because celebs don't get the hobo power that the blue collar people do, you know?
But I almost crapped myself in Hawaii once.
Okay, I'm going to give that a 7.
7? All right, thanks.
Well, what about the aliens and Starship Troopers? They must have stunk something awful, yes?
No, they were all CG. We never even saw
that was
them.
A make, that
tennis
was a movie,
balls on a stick.
He didn't actually fight aliens.
What do you mean?
Hey, there's things where they can't. It's like a play they put on, but it's 2 hours long and they film it.
But, I mean, they found those monsters somewhere.
No, it's like Star Wars. It didn't really happen.
I don't know what you're speaking of right
there
now.
Was no back, real Darth Vader.
Don't. What?
All right.
Listen, I want to know this much, though. Everybody, you're talking about Denise Richards. What about the underrated Dizzy? The one who played Dizzy?
Dina Meyer.
Now, that's a fox.
Yeah.
Underrated. She's with Rico, Johnny Rico in the picture. That's
that.
Her lover.
And you got to see her naked in that big shower scene.
That's yes.
Correct. Denise Richards, yes, contractually, that could not happen.
Yeah. And
but Dina Meyer, she'll drop trowel.
And the foxy Casper Van Diem, too.
Yes, that's right.
Tarzan. Right. All right, let's take ourselves a little break. I think we'll play some hypothetical question. With Neil Patrick Harris.
Woo-hoo.
Yeah, it's exciting. Monday nights, 8:30, CBS How I Met Your Mother. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carell Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
Yeah, Adam Carell here. Neil Patrick Harris in studio. How I Met Your Mother, named his new TV show. CBS Monday nights, 8:30. We'll be watching tonight. Going to play a little hypothetical with Neil. Also, Big Tad, who's hanging out at the Coffee Bean dressed as a brownie. Hey, Big Tad.
I'm a Girl Scout. I'm not a brownie.
I know. I called him a brownie, and he tried to eat himself. He actually he got halfway into his leg, and I said, no, not brownie, a Girl Scout. And then I went Weebolo, and he tried to do something weird to himself. So we're going with Girl Scout now. Sorry, Big Tad. Girl Scout. I didn't mean to insult your dignity.
Yeah,
Girl Scout. Yeah. So how many cookies? How many boxes have you sold?
I don't know how many boxes, but I've made $72 so far.
All right. Mm-hmm. So you've sold
Can't count.
Yeah, well, it's like 9 boxes. What was that, 4? No, it's like 19 boxes or something like that, or 18 boxes, something like that. Because they're like $4 a box, right? All right. 18 boxes.
Heaven forbid he'd be able to keep track of a number that high.
Yeah. Are you selling for $4 a box, or are you charging more? Are you making tips?
No, some people have been giving me tips, which I will give to the cause, but I am selling them at $4 a pop.
Okay, and which ones are selling the most or the best?
The Samoas.
The Samoas?
Yeah.
Okay, what's second?
Second would be Thin Mints, and then it's a tie for third between Do-Si-Dos, the Trifles, and the Tagalongs.
If anybody, what kind of society are we living in where there's a tie for third between the Tagalongs, the best ones, the peanut butter ones, and the Trefoils, the ones that are made of shortbread? What kind of society is this? I ask you.
It's a melting pot.
Yeah, it's a melting pot that someone has defecated in. They've mistaken it for a chamber pot. That's what happened to our melting pot. I'm running for president. I'm going to yell, it's a melting pot, not a chamber pot. And everyone's going to go nuts, and I'll walk off the podium. And they'll never know what it means. And then I'll finish with, a vote for me sends a message to the fat cats in Washington. And then I'll walk off stage again. A place will go nuts, and we'll win. It's a melting pot, not a chamber pot. Thank you. And I'm growing crazy facial hair. I'll be known as the guy who brought back the mutton chop. I'm going to put on 80 pounds. I'm going to get a watch on a chain, and I'm going to grow crazy facial hair, big mutton chops, and I'm going to yell, it's a melting pot, not a chamber pot, and I'll yell, good day.
Smart.
And that's it.
And toss Girl Scout cookies.
Girl Scout cookies. Tad.
Yes, sir.
If anybody tries to buy any of those shortbread trefoils, I want you to go, okay, 5, let me grab that box, let me get your change, and just go upside their head with the box. And then jump on them and beat them. Beat the life out of them. Okay?
Yes, sir. Yes,
and scream, you deserve to die. I'm putting you out of your misery. I'm doing you a favor.
The Girl Scout way.
Yes.
That's right. I could shoot you, but that wouldn't be the Girl Scout way. This is the way we do it. Yeah.
While I'm doing this, I've learned 2 things. A, it's really hard to pick up girls with a dress on.
Yeah. Or and an extra 200 pounds.
Yeah,
they're both tough.
And no one likes to, there's not a lot of people that likes to buy Girl Scout cookies from a fat man.
Well, maybe it reminds them. Maybe it's like looking into a mirror. You know what I mean? You want to buy cigarettes from a guy who's talking to you through a trach hole. You don't want to buy Girl Scout cookies. That's why they send Girl Scouts out to do it. Like, look at her. She's 40 pounds. I could eat all I want. Yeah, because looking at Big Tad, it's buying smokes from the Grim Reaper. It's just it's sad. Guy with a sickle. All right. We're going to play a little hypothetical question with Neil Patrick. Patrick Harris here. There are no wrong answers, by the way.
I'm a little nervous about this.
No.
Just top of my head kind of answers?
Top of your head.
All right.
Again, it's not a trivia question. It's not the highest peak in North America. This is just do you want to go cross-country with this guy, or do you want to go with that guy? There are no wrong answers.
No wrong answers.
No wrong answers.
Okay, I'm ready.
All right, let's see. Oh, number one. So you're driving cross-country with this guy.
All right.
Who would you rather drive cross-country with? This guy. God damn, do I hate this guy. This is the guy who tells you he has an idea for a TV show, killer idea for a TV show, and then you go, oh, well, what is it? And he goes, I can't tell you.
Oh.
I just can't. My agent would, yeah. We got to wait till we finish the paperwork before. As if you would steal it or as if it's an idea that's worth a damn. Okay. That guy or the blowhard sober guy. 50s. Ponytail, huge calves, got a little bit of a gut on him, wears cargo shorts, and tells you the dates all the time. December 21st, 1977, took my first sip of grain alcohol. But he tells you when he buried his wives and stuff and gives you the dates.
It seems like he would ramble on more. It seems like the TV guy, in his silence, would probably be the better person to ride with.
Okay, wrong. Sorry.
I thought there was no wrong answer.
Well, there isn't. That was the first one we've ever had.
Confounding.
Yeah. This just in, Casper Van Dien or Vinny from Doogie Howser?
Wow, it would have to be Vinny from Doogie Howser.
I'm sorry.
No, really?
Yeah.
Casper?
Well, Casper's probably had a lot of hot chicks in the sack, and he could thrill you with those stories.
He would
you know
tell
what
good
I mean?
Stories.
Yeah, he'd tell you.
He was always exercising, though, so he sort of kind of always smelled like chicken.
Oh, really?
He always had that, you know, I'm... Freshly yeah. eating raw protein, eating raw meat all the time.
He was so good. At a certain point, when you get too good looking, you actually get ugly. I think that's what happened to him. He actually got so good looking, he was unattractive.
He wanted to be Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
He'd chomp on cigars and want to be a politician.
So you didn't care for the man?
No, I like him a lot.
All right.
He just smelled like chicken and smoked cigars.
All right. Nicole Richie or Debbie Allen? This is tough. Debbie Allen, proud woman.
She
very
is.
Proud.
Nicole, I can't be. I could never be in a car with Nicole Richie. I gotta go, Debbie Allen.
No! I'm sorry. Oh, talking to you about the majesty of dance all the way. How proud she is.
Think of all the Oscar stories you could
hear. Yeah, but critiquing you on your posture.
That's.
Come on, that would suck. All right, NASCAR fan or Hasidic Jew? Yeah. There's the funk factor for both of them.
There
either way, you'd have to have the window cracked.
I gotta go Jew.
Yeah!
There's no wrong answers.
There wasn't.
It NASCAR never... people smell like those pork rinds.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? I'm going to reverse my ruling on that one because the NASCAR guy is going to be spitting into that cup.
Oh, true.
Is there anything less attractive than the guy who's got the tobacco spittle into the... I'd rather you just do it on me than that cup and then eventually gets to be a big cup of your horrible tobacco-laden spittle. And eventually, someone's going to get drunk and take a swig.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes.
In that big gulp cup.
Oh,
that's not
yeah.
cute.
Guy just talk. By the way, they just talk and just talk and, oh.
He won't get that from the Hasidic
foul.
Jew.
Rachel, you can't. No, they don't dip.
It is foul.
The Hasidic Jews, say what you will about the Hasidim, they don't dip. I'll give their people that. Rachel, you'd never go out with a guy who dipped, would you?
Oh, I have.
You have?
Oh, yeah.
But he was a professional athlete or something, right? He wasn't a NASCAR fan. He played ball, right? He played ball.
I wouldn't say ball.
But, I mean, he was an athlete.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hockey.
Yeah.
Played puck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hockey.
Here's the whole thing. Women will look the other way if the athlete dips, because once in a while there is an athlete who dips. But... the NASCAR guys, that's just the fat guy with the, you know.
That's not a sport.
Wall trip jacket on. Yes. All right, where were we? Vegan girl or Wiccan girl?
What's the second one?
Wiccan. It's that witchy religion that the chicks get into, you know?
That'd be kind of hot. Exciting.
No, sorry.
No,
you're thinking, yeah, I know, you're thinking Eagle Song witchy woman, but these are just fat diesel dykes. You want nothing to do with them and angry at their stepdad.
Well, okay.
And of course, you become daddy.
Better than the vegan girl?
Yeah, I'll tell you, vegan girl at least could be hot.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, she's gonna have the unshaved pits and other parts and everything, but she's gonna be good looking. She's not gonna be angry at her dad. You will become
a healthy head of hair.
Yeah, health, and you become daddy by the time you get to Arizona. You're stepdad. You know what I mean? Think about it. All right. Oh, last guy. You ready?
All right.
Now, really, really going to need your focus now. I think you're one or two for like 19. Remember, there's no wrong answers. Pierced nipple guy.
Ooh.
This is the guy with the double nipple piercings who never has his shirt on. Mm. You're just stared. you're forced to stare at the guy's nipples. Okay, this guy versus the guy who buys the cop bike at the police auction. Also gets the cop helmet, the black and white two-toner, and the leather jacket, and just drives around like he's a cop, doing 33 behind you. Everyone's slowing down on the freeway at night because they see the fairing coming up and the two-tone helmet. Which one of these a-holes?
Well, I got to think, on a cross-country trip, the last person you'd want is someone who wanted to be a cop, because you're going to want to go extra
I'm
fast.
Sorry.
You're terrible at this game.
Yeah, you're right. There's no wrong answers, but
I feel
the pierced
so
nipple
wronged.
Guy's got his shirt off the whole time.
Yeah, that's true. There's funk there.
Yeah.
There's some stink
there.
You're
smelling him. You're looking at his nipples. The cop guy's nothing. He doesn't wear his helmet. He doesn't have his bike. His superpowers are gone. It's like Batman without his utility belt.
I hate this
All right, listen. Let's break it up.
Most people do.
Let's take some phone calls. It was a nice try, Neil.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, I mean, you know.
I failed.
You're one. One for like 26. That's solid.
That's a 22, isn't it?
We have Jason on the line. Jason?
Yeah.
You have a story for us?
I got a funny story. It involves Doogie. Or Neil.
Sorry. Neil, how are you? What's going on?
In fact, that's the crux of the story. I was at this party, like, I don't know, 8 or 10 years ago in West L.A., and where all my buddies and I come up from Hermosa Beach, and we get there, and there's a celebrity at the party. Well, it's Neil.
Uh-oh.
And so it's this house party, and we end up downstairs in, like, this private room, and, like, five of us in there. Neil's in there with us, and this joint comes out and starts going around in the circle.
Oh, boy.
And I'm like, oh, boy, I'm going to smoke a joint with Doogie. This is cool. So Doogie smokes it. My buddy, Jeff, keeps calling him Doogie. And Neil's getting mad. He's like, my name is Neil. Please stop calling me Doogie. And my buddy goes, whatever, Doogie.
Wow. Classy.
That's so bad for you, Neil.
Classy.
It's been a tough morning for you. First one for 26 and hypothetical question. Now, Jason over here. Do you remember this
bitter,
story?
Angry stoner.
Is he making this up?
Can't have been the first time that's happened to you.
Off of Santa Monica Boulevard.
Yeah, that probably happened. Yeah, I don't recall it by the day, but that wouldn't surprise me.
It did. Are you a single man, Neil?
No, I'm spoken for.
You are?
Yes.
But back in the day, your carefree bachelor days.
Back in my carefree bachelor days, I went to a house party or two.
And the whole Doogie thing must have translated into some lovely female action, right?
You got some attention.
Well, not only were you a celebrity, but here's the whole thing about women. They're a little bit dizzy and they blur the lines. You know, that's why they write the soap opera stars act. They write them letters telling them to stop cheating on their make-believe families and stuff like that. You were a doctor. And not, so you're a doctor and an actor. But you're a celebrity doctor.
I always looked like a little kid. So
yeah, but that's
never
the
like
other part,
the big studly guy that people wanted to have sex with because I was on a TV show. I was like this adolescent, geeky-looking guy with a big Adam's apple in ears. You
but
know?
But women could save you. They could mother you.
Yeah, a few did. I won't lie.
All right. Mike?
Yeah, I'm here.
Question for Neil.
Well, he should have been a pediatric gynecologist or something, but my question was...
Wow.
Well, yeah, thanks.
Pediatric gynecologist.
That's hot.
Well, you're young. I'm just... Okay, I'm back to the question.
All right.
Sing for us, buddy. I know you can blow. Let's get some Bohemian Rhapsody or something.
Oh, wow.
Yes, I've heard you're a fine singer.
Is this the real life? That was terrible.
No, it was good.
Wow. That was tragic.
You haven't heard us sing.
Do we have a tuning fork?
Let's hear some of our singing
I've heard
here
you
on
guys
the show.
Sing.
Yeah, Michael, bring it up. Did you start doing musical theater?
No, I started singing in church when I was a little tyke.
Mm-hmm. And you still sing today?
Yeah, I do actually. I've sung a lot of musical theater. I did Rent here, and then I did the big cabaret show.
Do you enjoy it? Because for me, the only time I feel like I'm free. When I'm singing
it's
on
fun
stage.
To sing for about a week and a half, 2 weeks, but when you have to, like, a three-month run where you have to sing at good voice all the time.
You're doing two shows on Saturdays and Sundays.
That gets tough.
Do you have a little for us? Who do you have for us, Mike?
I do the news.
That's our own Rachel Perry.
Wow.
Everything you need to know about George W.
Yeah.
How
wow.
I think we've all heard enough of that.
Yeah. At least you're not flat.
You have to rent some ear protection. All right.
My mom is going to call in now and tell you to stop playing that. When I was a little girl, I was singing and my mom told me to shut up.
I was a writer.
Oh, this is a producer, Braska, here.
Wow. Sober? Were you sober?
No.
Yes, it was 7 in the morning.
Can't even say his own name right.
All right, this is getting sad. I want to thank Neil Patrick Harris for coming in and doing a wonderful job.
My pleasure.
Being a sport.
Keep up the good work, everyone.
Thank you. How I Met Your Mother, Monday nights,
tonight.
8:30.
This
tonight,
very night.
CBS. I will be home this evening at 8:30 watching it my own
self. Hilarity.
Come back anytime you like, Neil.
Thank you, sir.
We'll be right back after this.
Hi, this is Stewie Griffin. Call Adam Carolla now at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Yes, indeed. 866-901-ADAM. We got some news. We got some sports coming up. Big Tad's still down on La Cienega in third, pimping those cookies. $78. Who the hell would... Okay. I get angry every time I think about the Trefoils selling over my beloved Tagalongs. But Ed is in Las Vegas. Ed is a correspondent we hooked up with in Las Vegas. He's right across the street from the hotel we're going to be at. What hotel are we going to be at, Breska? At the Palms. Be nice if we could... Oh, there we are. At the Palms. That's right. On the 9th, 3 to 7. Ed?
Hello?
You there?
Yeah.
Good to talk to you again, Ed.
Hey, how say you, Adam?
I say yay. How say you, Ed?
Yeah.
Okay. He knows the game well. Knows the game well. Ed, you're gonna review Desperate Housewives for us again this week, but it wasn't on.
No, I looked every channel. It wasn't on this week.
Yeah.
And they hope it didn't get cut off.
No, I think they just ran a special 2-hour Dancing with the Stars or something like that. But anyway, you have another story for us, Ed?
Well, I went out this weekend. I told the Brian about it. It was my son's birthday. And remember I told you he was about 26?
That's right. You have four sons, right?
He was just 24 years, and I got five boys. He's 24.
Right.
And I took him to Denny's for his birthday.
Mm-hmm.
And I, got a little money together, and we went over there down the road from the house.
Yeah.
And he drove.
Sure.
And we went there, and because they say the kids eat free over there
right.
at Denny's.
Right.
So we went over there and ordered our dinner.
Mm-hmm.
And when the bill came, they had my dinner on there and his dinner. And they tried to charge us for both.
Right.
So I took a marker and I scratched out what he ordered.
Wow, that's smart. You can do that. Works with the IRS. It works with everything. You just scratch out stuff you don't want to pay for. It's no problem at all.
So the waitress came back and then she told me I couldn't do that. And I said, well, it says here that the kids...
Hold on 1 second. This is why you can't work at Denny's. You got to deal with the Eds of the world who are scratching or modifying the bill. By the way, the bill that probably came to $9.53 for the bottomless salad bowl and the 53 refills on the Diet Pepsi, but still doing the mods on the check. Yeah.
Yeah.
Your argument is that he's your child, right?
Yes, he is.
And he should eat for free.
That's what it said.
Right. Kids eat free. But also, don't you eat free on your birthday?
I don't know.
Hey, it's not news that Denny's is racist.
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah. Yeah, see, I'm white, and we can go in there. We never pay at Denny's.
Mm.
I just go in there with all... Me and Damashek and Rachel and Breska, we all go in after the show, and we just walk in, and they're like, excuse me, and they bring us to a certain room that's for white people. I really shouldn't be talking about it. Ed, promise me you're not going to tell. Don't tell any of your black friends about this, but there's a whole white person room in the back.
I don't have many black friends.
Okay, good. I mean, okay. My point is there's a white person room at Denny's, and they don't even serve off the Denny's menu. It's all Spagos.
They didn't take me there.
And they don't, it's not the chili size and all that. It's all brisket, wonderful food, and they don't charge us. You just give them the white handshake before you leave. They know.
Next week, I will not be in Las Vegas.
Oh, where are you going to be?
I'm catching an airplane on Wednesday going to Indiana.
What are you going to do there?
Visit some family.
All right. Can we check in with you there?
Yeah, I don't know what time it is out there, though.
Well, we'll do the math and work it out.
Yeah, I'll be there. They should have that show on out there, too, I think.
Yeah, I think that's the way TV works. They don't just produce new shows for every time code in every district. They actually just make one show and then they send it out.
And then I'll be back I'm leaving on March 1 and come back March 6.
Okay. So can
and
you...
And then you'll be here.
I'll be there
on
the 9th.
I can't wait. Am I going to get to see you?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You said we were going to shake hands.
We're gonna press the flesh and then we're going over to Denny's. We'll be eating in separate rooms, but we're going to Denny's together.
And you said Dave will be there and Ray Ray and...
They're all going to be there.
The Brian?
Yeah, the Brian phone screener. The Brian's going to be there, and then we're all going to head to Spearmint Rhino.
Okay.
I'm going to buy you a lap dance. You ever had one of those?
Yeah.
You have?
Yeah, I got one that day at Scores.
Oh, but you said you only spent $13 at Scores.
No, 12.
12.
I didn't buy it. My friend gave
me your friend 20, bought?
He gave me a $20 bill and told me to give it to the girl.
Mm-hmm.
And while the music was playing, she stood up in front of me.
And danced around.
Yeah.
That's how they work. Finally, I've
That's
solved the riddle.
Money.
Did you like that?
It was all right.
Okay. Well, I'm going to buy you at least 10. You all right with that, Ed?
10 what?
Lap dances. And a grand slam.
I can do it.
All right, Ed. We're going to be there on the 9th. We'll see you then. And check back with us next week. We need you to watch Lost, all right?
Well, what day is that? Come on again?
I think it's Wednesday night.
Hope it's not 2 hours this time.
No, it'll be a shorter one. I think it'll just be an hour.
Okay, I'll watch it.
I know. Time's a very valuable commodity for you, Ed. Arguing with the waiter.
It gets tiring. It gets tiring.
No, I understand. I understand.
Watching TV.
All right, Ed. Yeah, it takes a lot out of a man watching TV. All right, we'll check in with you. Watch Lost.
All right.
We'll see you in Vegas. Bring your sons.
I'll bring one of them.
Bring the cop, not the criminal.
Okay.
All right, so you do have one son that arrested the other son, right?
No, I didn't say that.
Well, you said one's
That's silly, Adam.
Okay. Now I know you're lying. One's in jail and one's a cop, right?
No, one had gotten a little bit of trouble, but he's not in trouble no more. He's a good boy.
Okay.
He does things the right way now. He doesn't do that stuff no more. He don't want to get no whipping.
Okay.
What was he in the clink for, though?
Drinking while he was driving a car.
All right. It's not bad.
Man, you know, a lot of
into an orphanage.
That happened to me a long time ago, but I don't drink no more.
Right. So even the best will slip up every once in a while.
I don't drive either, so.
Right. Well, I would start drinking again if I didn't drive.
Stuff ain't good for you all the time.
All right, Ed, but I want you to get loaded, and we're going to get you some lap dances in Vegas, all right?
Okay.
All right. Very, very tentative okay from Ed. All right, we're going to take a break. We'll be back. We have sports. We got news. We got more show after this.
It's time for free advice from James Lights Out Tony.
Dear Mr. James Tony, I've been engaged to Zach for 3 years, but I don't know if I should marry him. My family has never approved of him, and they have put second thoughts into my mind. Zach has been in prison for the last 2 years and wants us to be married as soon as he gets out, which will be in another 3 years. When I read his letters or visit him, he scares me. Since he's been incarcerated, he's been on antipsychotic drugs and antidepressants, and he sees a therapist every month. He says things like, he'll be with me for all eternity and till death do us part. And if you ever leave me, I'll kill myself. Should I marry him? Lacking conviction in Texas.
Dear Lackey, this is a decision only you can make. Your fiancé is not the only one who has changed. You have changed too. Please bear in mind that this man wouldn't be in anti-socialized or psycho medication if he didn't have serious mental problems. Life doesn't always deal us a hand that we want. We all are responsible for our own lives and our own survival. Threatening suicide to force you to stay in a relationship is a classic form of manipulation, and I wouldn't do it.
Free advice from James Lights Out Tony.
Thank you, James Tony. I'll tell you, we do our Definitely Not a Jew every once in a while. Here's a guy who has a belt at 154 pounds and has a heavyweight belt as well. Definitely not a Jew. The man has belts in weight divisions that span 65 pounds. I saw the guy fight at 150 pounds. Now he's 230 pounds, and he hasn't been beaten in his last 15 fights.
And somehow finds the time to dispense, relationship advice.
Yeah, timely relationship advice. All right, that is James Lights Out Tony. We are now going to move forward and do the news with the beautiful Rachel Perry.
In the Middle East.
Yeah.
Someone. Oh, I'm sorry, I misread that. There's unrest in the Middle East.
Mm.
I did that wrong.
You know, I gotta say I'm sorry right now because I predicted, I think it was Friday,
yeah,
by Sunday, they would have all this worked out. Because, you rarely hear about any problems coming from that, emanating from that part of the world, because it's not the people. People, it's impossible. It's everyone's the same. All religions are the same. You can't judge. I figured it'd be over by Sunday afternoon at the latest. Turns out it's going into Monday.
I'll give it another week.
I'll give it until Wednesday. But then it all settles down.
Yeah, give it till after the Oscars, I would say.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Now, speaking of the Middle East, this ports, U.S. ports situation, has been going on. And Bush apparently doesn't want any further investigations into it. But the company, Dubai Ports World, is calling for them to investigate their come on. They're like, bring it on. We want you to look at all our stuff. Apparently, it was all over the news this weekend and Meet the Press and all these things. And Schwarzenegger had some interesting things to say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw him on Meet the Press this weekend.
Yeah.
And it's a very complex issue because, you know, we have villainized the Arab world also so much that now an Arab country or company taking over our ports and maybe have some influence in our security, it freaks everyone out, and rightfully so.
Wow.
We villainized the did we all make true lies, or was that just you?
That was just him and Jamie Lee. Look, I just watched 60 Minutes last night and it said the same goddamn thing I said 1 week ago, which is we have been screwing up port security for the last 100 years. How are they going to F it up any more than we've already done it? CBS News took depleted uranium 5 years ago, shipped it from some port of call in some sort of Arab country, shipped it right to the port of Los Angeles, put it on a flatbed truck, and drove it through Los Angeles. Now, it wasn't an atomic bomb, but it could have just as easily been an atomic bomb or a dirty bomb, and it wasn't detected. How much worse is it going to get?
Well, here's what the problem is. Once you let foreigners start running port security, the next thing you know, they're going to want to be the governor.
That's a good point. Slippery slope.
Yeah.
You're right. They don't check any of the containers as it is.
All right. But, yeah, I can't imagine. A mystery named Adam Carolla. Mm-hmm. How can you give a pass to the idea of the people from the country where some of the terrorists came from?
Because I don't profile. I won't racially profile, and that's profiling. And the pussies who think everything that Bush does is wrong, and only 3/4 of the stuff he does is wrong. These are the people that are arguing against airport profiling, and now they want to profile countries who are doing port security. I say they're speaking out of both sides of their wussy mouth.
Well, this stuff has also been in the news, over there as well. Al Jazeera, there was an Al Qaeda representative commenting on it as
sure.
well.
Hear that.
Oh, that's so stupid! Stupid American! Stupid!
Oh. Almost use the F word there.
Even they're laughing at us.
Yeah. All right.
Well, Saddam Hussein ended his hunger strike after 11 days. I feel like he was like the kid who ran away from home and came back to check if anybody noticed he was missing.
I think they offered him some Grecian formula to eat a bagel. How many bagels do you think he puts down? You think they have bagels? That's what we got to do. We got to drop off. That's what they need. They need delicatessens over there. That would bring them over to the juice.
TiVo's.
Oh, I don't care delis. Where you're from. I don't care who you pray to. Some nice hot corned beef. Some pastrami.
Some of Cantor's pastrami.
Cantor's with the brown mustard on there.
Oh, yeah.
Where you take the coleslaw and you put it right onto that nice hot rye bread. That'll convert a Muslim over in a second. They'll be hugging and dancing the horror before the night's out. What kind of name is that, Sheck, for a Jewish dance? A horror?
I didn't come up with the name.
Well, still. All right.
Iraqi television is saying that they caught Al-Zarqawi. What the heck?
The guy looks like Ron Jeremy?
Yeah, but they didn't catch him.
Oh.
They caught his number two.
Wow, that's close. They got his DNA, at least.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Yeah, no, you meant number two guy.
Yeah, his number
two
guy.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that's okay.
I got confused.
Okay. Another new. It's Mardi Gras.
Yeah.
Woo.
Mm-hmm.
I told you a story the other day about a guy in Pennsylvania in McKeesport who apparently put a severed penis in a microwave of a convenience store.
Mm-hmm.
Turns out it wasn't a penis. It was a Wizinator, which is apparently the thing that you use if you have to take a drug test.
Ah.
And he needed the pee inside the Wizinator fake penis to be warm.
Can you imagine? Imagine if we could get one of the founding fathers over here for just a day of news. There's things called we test a man's urine and there's drugs that he imbibes, and so we've come up with a fake phallus to urinate through. Yeah. So that that's a long story, Abe. Yeah. Or George. Let's just keep moving.
He was going to a job interview that he had to take a drug test. So in entertainment, Dancing with the Stars last night had their finale.
Mm-hmm.
Are they trying to piss us off because they named Drew Lachey the winner last night?
From the Department of Rhetorical Questions, how does it feel?
Oh, so good. I can't even believe it right now. I'm in shock. I am shocked.
Drew. Woo!
Yeah.
That was Drew?
Yeah, that was Drew. They're trying to incite a rematch or something.
Yeah. I just watched the end. I only saw his dance. He seemed okay, but it seemed like maybe the other guys got jobbed by the voters. I think the people that were calling in weren't a big fan of the long-legged lady. Wanted to vote for
Drew. She was a fox. But here's the thing with that show. Why is every woman on it, this Lisa Rinna, chief among them, why is every woman on that show orange? Have you noticed that they're all, that they what is with the sunburns?
Well, because you can't be too skinny and you can't be too tan. And that's the whole thing. They drop, you know, the camera loves you skinny and it loves you tan. And they just keep going with it to the point where they look like jerky. There's like a pemmican out there dancing with a gay guy. Sad.
It's grotesque, really.
Grotesque.
They had to make a new magnet because when I was a little kid, I remember seeing at the beauty salon that my mom had, the girls that worked there had like a little magnet said, you can never be too thin or too rich.
Mm.
Can never be too thin or too tan.
Or too orange.
Or too orange. Yeah. Don Knotts, Mr. Furley died.
Yeah. Sad. He was funny. I watched a little Mayberry over the weekend as a tip of the hat to the Knotster. He was really good. He did a lot of really good work.
Loved him.
Yeah. Wow. Listen, I love Furley. Furley's dynamite.
He was
maybe gay kind of guy. The ironic that, you know, he resents Jack so much.
Yeah.
For what he is, really. But he's no Roper.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. I was going to say he'll be missed, but we won't really miss him. We got all the tapes. We're cool.
You know, by the way, Roper, remember when Roper would make one wisecrack every episode, and then he would turn to the camera and smile at it?
Yeah.
That was the greatest thing in sitcom history.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah, he'd make some thing about not wanting to F his wife and then turn to the camera.
His best zinger of the episode, he sort of would just turn to the camera and smile and then go back to the episode. Awesome.
Wow. There's a three companies curse because Ritter died, now Knotts.
Who's next?
Yeah.
Should we predict? Because they go in threes, don't they?
I hope it's Larry.
Joyce DeWitt.
I hope it's DeWitt or Larry.
Joyce DeWitt.
I didn't like his hair.
That's going to be the cruel twist, is that Larry Dallas is going to be the one who survives them all. Yeah, because Roper's dead, too.
Yeah. The curse. I like when people do a curse about shows that are 40 years old when people were in their 50s when they were doing the show. I'm like, well, he would have been 136. I don't know if it's exactly a curse.
And somebody who died over the weekend, Darren McGavin, who was the father on A Christmas Story, one of my favorite movies.
Sure,
yeah.
Not as exciting.
Sorry. Also, The Natural.
Sorry, The Death. Not ooh, he's
also the mean gambler in the Natural. Yeah,
yeah.
George Michael. Here's the big news over the weekend. George Michael was arrested on Sunday in London on suspicion of drug possession after being found slumped over the steering wheel of a car. And he apparently didn't have any drugs in his system, but he did have weed and GHB in his possession.
Yeah.
And also the trunk was filled with masks and sex toys.
I would argue if you're gay, you can use weed and GHB as a sort of a religious ritual. You know, like we do peyote with the American Indians.
Mm-hmm.
That's part of our tribe's deal.
Yeah.
We like to toke out, do a little GHB, you know, get our party on.
And
you're always slumped over a wheel. Never draped, never humped, never flopped. Always slumped over a steering wheel. They found him slumped over a steering wheel. It's never like they found him. He was over the steering wheel, but his posture was amazing. They're always slumped over a wheel. I hope they find me slumped over a wheel, but here's a twist. I want to be in my bed.
Slumped over a wheel in your bed.
Yes.
Is that
really confuse people. And it's going to be a ship's wheel to really add a twist to it. Where did they find him? In bed. Slumped over a ship's wheel. Wow. Talk about range. Corolla really had range.
Maybe that's the appropriate
we're gonna miss
term.
That's what they'll say. He had range.
We're going to miss that Corolla. He was rangy. Slumped over a captain's wheel in bed. Wow. I used to love the way he looked at the camera when he was slumped over the wheel. That's what they'll say. We'll miss him. Oh. Sorry, Rachel.
It's okay.
Done in by Captain Hook.
That's right.
And finally, over the weekend, the box office, the movies, Madea's Family Reunion was the big winner, $30.3 million. Coming in second, thanks to myself, who went to go see 8 Below, finally. Mm. I was a little bit disappointed with this Paul Walker movie.
Oh, he's one of the finest thespians of our time.
Well,
what are you talking about?
I thought I mean, I think that the title's a little bit misleading. I thought that it was a porno.
Ah, yeah, 8 Below, yeah, with Paul Walker.
Yeah, I
Ain't
was
nice,
but
Ain't half
instead,
below.
I was just crying all weekend thinking about these poor dogs.
Sad.
But it
yeah.
was an awesome movie. I loved it. That came in second. Pink Panther came in third. And that's it.
Huh. It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Winter games in Torino, over. Some might be thankful for that.
Yeah.
But we're going to have to wait 4 more years for luge and curling and other such assorted delightful events. The Nazis proved to be too much for us. They won 29 medals, including 11 gold. Yeah, we won a measly 25.
What a god.
And Canada came in at 24.
Here's the deal. Well, I argue there is no god. You round up and kill 6 million Jews and here's some gold medals for your trouble? Think about it. Think about the message God is sending to the rest
of
us.
God didn't give him the medals, you know, the day
after.
Well,
he does everything. Well, so he took a couple years off, then he gave him the gold. A horrible message to send your people, I would argue, Lord.
The big event yesterday, Sweden beat Finland to win gold in men's hockey. And there's a little bit of a controversy. Of course, there was the American speed skating controversy, two guys going head-to-head. Now Julia Mancuso, one of the best American female skiers, is getting ripped by Peekaboo Street.
Wow.
Peekaboo. one of the legends of the American skiing women. And she doesn't like that Julia Mancuso wore a tiara when she would do her runs. Here's what she had to say about it.
I think there's an immaturity and a lack of focus and a lack of professionalism there. And you get out of the games what you put into them. And
lack of professionalism? What do you mean? She didn't stick to training enough?
I don't know about the training. I mean, you can train super hard and still be unprofessional. She just has a lot of growing up to do and lose the tiara.
Wow.
I'm not so sure you're in any position to talk about one's maturity when your name is Peekaboo. Huh? Am I right?
It's true.
The games weren't too popular. The extreme sports jazz things up for some people, but not me. I'll tell you what the Olympics miss. The Soviet Union. We need an arch rival.
Yeah.
Formidable.
Drago.
Next games, Benny Laden and company.
Yeah.
You know.
Yes.
The Al-Qaeda. They need a team.
They need, and look, if they can't field one, we should go field one for them.
Listen, they're busy running our ports right now. So, yes, if we have to chip in, so be it. Now.
Oh, guys with the turbans and the beards flowing in the wind as they head down the hill in the giant slalom.
Yeah, what's wrong with them? Why aren't they involved?
That's a shocker. They lead the world in every other department. Science, history. I mean, they're at the vanguard of the space program.
Literature,
the cinema, interpretive dance. They do it all, these people. I can't believe they're not involved with the Olympics. It's a shocker.
Dynamite at curling, I'm sure.
Oh,
if only given the opportunity. NBA, the Kobe's lost here in L.A. last night to the Celtics. Portland lost to the Hornets. Did you see Kevin Garnett of the Timberwolves? He was upset with an official's call, so he threw the ball lightly into the stands. Really did not whip it. Sort of flipped it into the stands. Hit a guy right on the button, right on the honker, and the guy refused Kevin Garnett's attempts to apologize and had to be wheeled out in a wheelchair with his daughter sitting by. Now, is this the act of something that Adam Carolla would ever do? In front of a child, no less.
No.
Obviously angling for a lawsuit.
I could be at a track meet and one of the guys who was competing in the javelin event could turn toward me and launch the javelin through my sternum and pin me to the seat, and I would just sit there with a smile as long as the camera's on laughing. and apologize, and I couldn't get his javelin back.
I say shame on this man.
I say he's
trying to
cash in. People are smart now. They know the cameras are on. If you're going to do a court case and they see you laughing and shaking the guy's hand and laughing with your daughter, you still get some money. You get to tell the judge you were in shock, you feared for your life, but that was adrenaline and blah, blah, blah. But better, he's going to get another few $1 million if he just holds his nose and gets carried out of the place. He's going to cash in.
Where's the dignity, sir? Where's the dignity? Sugar Shane Mosley, last Saturday night, whipped Fernando Vargas, junior middleweight fight. Did you see Fernando Vargas after the fight? This isn't particularly great radio, but I do want to show it to Ace to show his favorite sport.
Wow.
Look at that.
Wow. Brutal.
I encourage all to look it up online. It's some grotesque sight, not unlike the Elephant Man.
There's a little bit of swelling around his left eye.
Ugh.
I'm going to do
looks
the...
Looks like he's hiding a grapefruit in there.
I'm going to do the math and say, and go out on a limb and say that Sugar Shea's right hand was finding its mark.
Yes, yes. Apparently he bludgeoned them something awful. And lastly, I was laid up sick all weekend, as we already talked. I was stuck inside watching TV. You know what they did for 5 or maybe 6 hours
hold on
ESPN?
Hold on. Let me ask you this. On a normal weekend, right, what are you out, wind sailing? you're stuck inside watching TV with your phone off every goddamn weekend. What are you talking about?
When I have the opportunity to use sickness as an excuse to watch TV, I'll take it,
no,
sir.
But please, you're watching TV every weekend. You're not going to leave the house. All right. So anyway, this time you were coincidentally sick.
I happened to be ill. So right. I was looking forward to watching some ESPN. I figure college basketball and the like on there. No. 6 hours of fishing.
Oh.
What gives?
I know.
It's not enough. I have to watch people play cards on TV.
I know. Look, here's what...
People drive?
Here's what happened to this once proud country. Obviously, there's too many goddamn networks now. There's too many hours in the day, and we can't fill it. There's not enough programming. So we're having bass fishing tournaments. Bowling is having marathons. It's NASCAR every 10 minutes. They're doing the card playing. We're now watching people play cards. That's a form of torture. If you really think about it, is there anything worse than when you go to Vegas and you crap out or you get tapped out at the 21 table and you have to step back because your drink hasn't come yet? I'm such a horrible gambler. I lose all my money before the comp drink I ordered 8 minutes ago gets to the table. Nothing sadder than me having to collect the drink standing behind the table. No, I had the Greyhound. Yeah, I had the Greyhound. I wish I could tip you, sweetie, but the point is then you do that thing where you stand behind your buddy who's playing 21, and you're like, dude, let's go catch a show, let's go to a club. Hey, wait a minute, buddy, come on, buddy, let's go to a club or something. Let's go look at some chicks. No, hey, buddy, I'm still playing. That 8 minutes standing behind him is torture. Can you imagine sitting at home watching this?
How does anyone sit around?
And so they to try and stimulate, I guess, some sort of interest in this, there was a big controversy in the Bassmasters Classic.
Sure.
One of the best guys, I guess, is this Mike Iaconelli guy.
Oh, he's a household
name. Why do I know his name? This isn't a sport. So Mike Iaconelli, I guess, he was upset about something that happened while he was fishing, and I was watching him fish. And he kicked something into the water, and I guess this was a penalty. Ooh. And it's, you know, a scandal. But he refused to apologize. Listen to what he had to say here.
I'm an emotional person, and I show my emotion, and that's how I am. That's how I fish.
Yeah.
Well, he's an emotional person. That's how he fishes.
He fishes angry.
With emotion.
That can hurt him sometimes. He's the Bodie Miller of bass fishing. I saw the commercials. They're like, last year, an amateur won the bass fishing tournament. Of course an amateur won. You could get drunk and tad, put him some cutoff sweats, get him loaded on some lucky lager, and he could go win any given bass tournament. Please.
I can't imagine. Well, he's an emotional guy. That's how he fishes. That's what Grammy used to say. The late Grammy used to say, I'm an emotional person. That's how I sew. That's that.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
All right, we got to take a break. We got Howard Cosell coming into the building. We're going to do a little football. Tad?
Hey, what's happening?
I need you to collect your cookies and your money and come back to the studio, please.
I will do.
Make haste.
We are leaving right now.
All right, when you tell Tad to make haste, he turns it up to glacier speed. He has a little setting that says Glacier. Well, one setting is napping, the other is Glacier. He's going to set it on Glacier and get over here. We'll take a quick break. Howard Cosell here for a little Monday morning football, Big Ten, all that after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
Yes, indeed, indeed. 866-901-ADAM. We're going to play a little Monday morning football. Football season's over. Oh, just hearing those words, even if they come from my own mouth, painful. I decided, you know, we could just go ahead and keep gambling and keep being enthusiastic about football because I don't remember who won what game, especially 35 years ago. I was saying that Monday Night Football should just be played on Monday nights and just start from 1970 when it was first conceived and go all the way through to present day. You'd always have that 35-year buffer because you'd never catch up to real time. But why not gamble on it?
Well, it hit really hit home for me. Of course, I miss football too, but it really hit home for me this weekend when fishing was on TV and poker. This is what's replaced football.
If only there was another channel.
I know. And the fact that there should be angry mobs with torches out front of the stations that do this. Instead, you always have a-holes defending. I like watching the
NASCAR
poker.
NASCAR is the second most popular sport.
Oh, please. All right, so here's what we have. We have ourselves a $750 3-in-1 game table featuring bumper pool, poker, you can watch them play, Shaq, and pool. Yes, from the Bernie Mac Show, and I'll be playing for awesome. Ed.
Yes.
I'm going to play for you, Ed.
You are?
Yeah, and maybe Vinny, who's on line two. Sheck will play for Vinny. Vinny?
Yes, sir.
All right, you mind? Sheck has been doing pretty good at this game. I think he's beat me twice.
Sheck's the man, and he doesn't like the Nazi, so I'm with him.
Yeah.
Yes, Vinny, yes.
All right, so hold tight. I'll play for Ed. Sheck will play for Vinny. And we'll take, these are actual games played on Monday Night Football in 1973. Howard Cosell is in studio. We've not gone online and figured out who won the game, so we'll just bet on them as if they were never played. Go ahead, Howard.
A pleasure to be back here in the studio with you, Adam.
Great to
have
you.
A man who is truly what the zoetrope was to the motion picture, to the radio industry.
Thank you.
The Green Bay Packers, host to Joe Namath and the New York Jets when the Monday Night Football season commences.
Mm-hmm. Packers and Jets.
I'll go first.
Yeah.
Wow. Neither team really in their respective
73,
primes.
73, yeah.
Yeah, Namath worn out. You know what? Since he's from the Pittsburgh area, I'm going with Broadway Joe.
All right. I'll go Packers.
John Brockington ran like an ape for 73 yards.
Wait a minute.
And MacArthur Lane for 60 as the Packers toppled the Jets 23-7.
Yeah! Yeah. Ed.
Yes.
We're up one.
All right. I love it.
Yeah. $750 for the pool table.
Yeah.
I know. It's
nice. Three-way pool table. That's awesome.
Yeah. This is not a bucket of wings. This is nice. All right. Let's keep going, Howard.
Let's move on with week number two. Archie Manning and the New Orleans Saints journey to Texas to face the Tom Landry-coached Dallas Cowboys.
73. Cowboys not doing that good in 73, but Saints always horrible with Manning at the helm. I'm going to go Cowboys.
Of course. It's got to be Staubach and the Cowboys.
Sure.
Unsurprisingly, Dallas wins 40-3. With this accomplishment, Tom Landry becomes the 10th coach to record 100 victories. Tom Landry, a man whom even in victory is a 10th place loser.
He'll be missed.
A fitting homage to
great,
the late,
great man.
Great
yes,
Landry.
You'll not be entering the circle of honor for anytime soon or is at the ring. All right, so Shaq, 1-1,
correct.
Ace man. 2-0. Let's keep going, Howard.
Moving on to week 5 of Monday Night Football, quarterback Dan Horn and the Cleveland Browns welcome Bob Greasy and the Miami Dolphins into town.
Mm-hmm.
So,
you, Shaq?
Well, obviously, I'm going to go with Greasy and company.
Right.
Dolphins.
Yeah, I'd say that, too. I'm going to go Browns just so I can yell at Rebruska if they don't win.
If I'm not mistaken, this is their second of back-to-back Super Bowl crowns for the Dolphins.
Yeah, so they have to win, but I'm just going to yell at Brusk if they clobber the Browns.
Larry Csonka powered his way to 114 yards and two touchdowns as the Dolphins rally for a 17-9 come-from-behind victory. Miami, a town quite amatory of the concept of coming from behind.
A racy Cosell today.
Wow, working blue. All right, so now, is it tied up?
That's right. It's 2-2.
2-2.
Come on, Vinny.
Both have two wins. Go ahead.
The betting score, 2-2, working into week number 10. Coach Norm Van Brocklin and the Atlanta Falcons play host to Sir Francis of Talkington and the Minnesota Vikings.
I'm going to go Sir Francis. Throwing to who else? Ahmad Rashad!
Sammy White, Joe Sensa and company.
Yeah,
I will go. All right, you know what? I can't. I know too much to go against the Vikes. It's got to be the Vikes.
Talkington leads an aerial assault, connecting on 17 of 30, but falls short. Falcons over the Vikings, 20-14. Falconry not my sport of choice, but preferred to Nordic rape and pillage.
That's true for most people, though.
All right, we're tied up. We both lost, but we're still tied up, right?
Dang. Yeah, last one, and then we have a tiebreaker after this.
Ed?
Yep.
Well, Ed, we're all tied up, buddy.
Wow.
Playing for that pool table, bumper table, bumper pool table, poker table. $750 wow. value.
Yeah.
That means you can get $85 for it on eBay. Score yourself some crack. All right, hang on. I'm playing for you. Vinny.
Yeah.
It's tied up.
Keep Vinny on the line. I don't want the bad mojo on my head. I'm going to let Vinny make the pick himself. This is
his
pool table.
Are you going to let me make it? Well, okay, we're going to take this one home then.
All right. Go ahead, Howard. Last
the
one. Tiebreaker.
With the tiebreaker. The Pittsburgh Steelers, led by ignoramus Terry Bradshaw, hit the road to face Don Shula's Miami Dolphins.
Vinny takes the Steelers.
Yeah, definitely. I'm going for the Steelers.
You're going Steelers?
I'm going for the Steelers.
All right, I'm going Miami then.
Miami scores all of its points in the first half and holds off a furious second half surge by the Steelers for a 30-26 victory.
Oh.
Dang!
A brainless Bradshaw can't give away that extra chromosome.
Ed! You won!
Man, I love it.
Exciting.
I love it.
Yep.
Sorry to Vinny.
All right. Where do you live, Ed? You're out in Fresno?
I live in Fresno, Central California.
Do you have enough room in that one bedroom for a little bumper pool?
You know what? My wife's going to have to sleep outside.
Yes.
Yep.
All right.
And then maybe I'll invite her in on the table.
Yeah. All right. Hang on, Ed.
All right.
I almost said nice job, but you didn't do anything. All right. Thank you, Howard. It was a wonderful job, as usual.
My pleasure. Witness the adulation.
Big Tad is back. He's brought his cookies. We'll see how his tally went, and we'll do that after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Remember, he loves you too.
Big Tad has made his way back in the studio.
Hey, what's going on?
Let me get a look at you, Big Tad. Step back a little. Let me see the skirt. Yeah, that's nice.
You like the legs?
Big calves.
Yes.
No. You like the legs?
No.
He's dressed as a brownie. We had him out.
Girl Scout,
sorry. Had him out on the street selling cookies as part of his punishment for not losing weight. He only lost 3 pounds last time, but still looking good, Tad.
Thank you.
And approaching the 300-pound barrier, yes?
I'm trying.
When is the last time you were under 300 pounds? Third grade?
How dare you? No, actually, the last time I was under 300 pounds was when I was working for another radio station.
What, you were Big Tad when you were working for K-Rock?
Yeah.
Really? How long ago was that?
When was the last time the Lakers won the champion? Or the first time they won the championship against Indianapolis? I can't remember that year. 99?
I don't know.
99?
I'm distracted by you and all that green. You look like a watermelon with a goatee.
So that was the last time you were under 300 pounds. And when is the last time a woman was under your 300 pounds? 2 years plus?
2 years ago, yeah.
So it's been a while.
It's been a while.
So we're going to try to get you to lose the weight so you can get laid, yes?
Yes.
All right. How many cookies did you sell?
I sold approximately about 21 boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I made $94.
And which ones were the big sellers?
The Samoas. They were, I sold 10 boxes of Samoas.
Mm-hmm.
Six boxes of Thin Mints. Three boxes of Dosidos. Two boxes of Tagalongs.
No!
Yeah.
What the God's name is going on in this country? The plain doughy ones, the sugar cookies outsold my beloved Tagalongs?
No, beautiful. How do you say them? Trefoils?
Yeah, trefoils or whatever the hell they are.
One box. I sold one box.
Oh, one box.
Yeah.
All right, what sold three? Then wait a minute. I got screwed up.
Dosidos. The peanut butter ones, yeah.
Oh, those are just the straight peanut butter cookies.
Yes.
But even those outsold their scrumptious cousin, the Tagalongs?
Yeah, there wasn't that many buyers for those. A lot of the people love Samoas.
They love the
coconut.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with those. They're good. They're better than the Thin Mints.
Don't talk like that.
It's true.
You say things to upset me.
I am saying this. I've said this. Here's the thing about the Thin Mints. Thin Mints are good when you have a jug of milk and you're going to do the whole row. You know, when you pull the whole, you're running the row. You're running the table. You got a nice buzz. It's 4 in the morning. You polished off a pizza. And now you're bringing out a jug of milk for a little dessert. But just cookie for cookie. Only if I had to enter an international cookie competition where all the greatest countries of the world got together and they're only able to offer one cookie on behalf of their country, I would offer the Tagalong. Thank you.
I'm sorry. That's incorrect, I'm afraid. You could, by the way, the Thin Mints, this could revolutionize the restaurant business. Instead of after-dinner mints and after-dinner cookie, and only the Thin Mint could fill that role.
True.
One cookie? Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's got the mint thing, and that's a palate cleanser, so I'll give you that. You know, my idea for a restaurant? It's called extra cheese. You know the guy, you know when you go to an Italian restaurant, and the guy's got that grinder, that hand cheese grinder?
Sure.
Nothing better than that when he puts the Parmesan in there and he grinds the thing on top of the pasta. Rachel, you're already shaking your head?
I couldn't think of a worse fate for me.
Oh, you're lactose intolerant.
A pain beyond.
Really? I would like to take you out and gas you up and just watch you go.
It would be like what happened to you this weekend.
Really?
Yeah.
Just on the pot.
Oh, like pain.
I would like to take you out,
pain.
Give you some nice cheese ravioli, grind a little of that mozzarella, and melt some provolone over it, and then just let you go like a balloon. right into the skyline.
It's an affliction.
But you love cheese, right?
It's a handicap.
Do you love cheese? You should get special parking.
No, yeah, I should.
What would the placard look like?
Just in case I eat some dairy by accident and need to get to a facility, a restroom-style facility,
What would happen if you ate one of those little triangles? You know, the ones with the little cow on it, the little mini Gouda, whatever those things are called.
I'm highly...
Little baby bell.
Lactose intolerant.
If you ate one of those, we'd have to run out of here?
Yeah.
But do you like cheese and you're tortured because you can't eat it?
No, I'm not like a huge dairy fan. No. I can eat goat cheese. It's fine. No.
If you get gassy, though, I can't imagine that is much of a problem. Don't the birds that live in your vagina, you know, flap their wings and... Don't they just flap their wings and, you know...
All right.
By the way, I'm going to let Ted keep the money.
What?
He was a good sport. The money that you've been earned, I'm going to let you keep it.
That's very big of you.
But on the other hand, you have to wear that hat now for the rest of the month.
Yeah, the felt
green beret.
Felt beret.
You look charming.
Thank you.
So cute.
All right, Big Tad. Thanks, guys. Cookies and skedaddle.
Well, they're actually Jimmy's. I feel sorry
for you. I'm taking the cookies.
Yeah, he's taking the cookies. I'm taking the
money. Obrusca, you bought the cookies?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
And you're giving him the money? Did you pay for it with your own money?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, hopefully Jack Silver's listening again to expenses.
Well,
I doubt it.
He says he...
Are you sure you don't want this back?
We'll see what Jack Silver says.
He's a pretty big Mark and Brian fan, so I don't know if he's listening, but during the air check, we'll let him hear this.
I'll take the Thin Mints.
All right, give everyone the cookies. Let's take our final break before we come back 20 hours later. I want to thank for coming in, Ted Casablanca, for coming in here and dishing the dirt. God bless him for doing that.
I think he may be gay. Neil Patrick Harris, How I Met Your Mother, Monday nights, 8:30 on CBS. Howard Cosell. A naughty Howard Cosell. Bill Cott doing that wonderful impression. Also, I want to thank the Fox Network for donating the pool table from the Bernie Mac Show. Friday nights, 8 o'clock on the aforementioned Fox. Howie Mandel, Kyle Gass from Tenacious D in here tomorrow. Jon Stewart coming in at the later in the week, or at least calling in. I think Kimmel's coming on later in the week as well, so we got that to look forward to. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo.